It's alive!
Dominic Lawton can be wild. Welcome to the Bad Movie Cult.
Hello and welcome to the Bad Movie Cult podcast, where each week we guide you through a film, and by the end of the episode we decide if it's good enough or bad enough to be inducted into the Bad Movie Cult. And with me on this journey is my co-host, my cohort, Mr. Ken B. Wild.
Hello everybody, and what a film we've got this week.
The whole point of this month was to do this film.
Was this, yes. I apologise for inventing another very, very niche genre, specifically just to get this film in. We didn't really need a reason, did we?
No.
But we took it.
Yeah, we took it and ran with it. But we are finishing this month on an absolute beauty to make up for the last two abominations. It is, of course, the 1994 Steven Seagal-directed film... On Deadly Ground.
In this land of frozen beauty, where a proud people make their home, Aegis Oil is making a killing.
The people here want to talk about the poisons in their environment.
If Aegis 1 is not online and operational in 13 days, then the oil rights will revert back to the Eskimos, and that is not going to happen.
But there is hope. And now, he's here. Steven Seagal is on deadly ground.
You're an oil man.
But I put out the fires. I stop spills.
We are being lied to by some of the most sophisticated people on Earth.
I know we've had our disagreements.
How much money is enough?
I don't need that kind of problem right now.
Get rid of the problem.
You mean mercenaries?
Now this land has a friend.
In you, I've seen a great spirit.
These people have a warrior.
Did you beat up on this little native man?
And this corporation...
Find me a buddy or find me the man.
...has a big problem.
And who the hell is this guy?
Sensei's company.
Company?
CIA.
Whatever he is, he's a damn problem.
Time to move out.
Michael Caine.
He'd need a miracle to stop us now.
Just gonna reach out and touch somebody here.
On deadly ground.
Got a plot for you, Ken?
Yes, please.
An expert firefighter fights back against the environmental destruction caused by his ruthless employer.
Really? So he was a firefighter then? That was his role?
Apparently so, yeah.
Because I watched this, finished it yesterday, I didn't know what his job was. Yeah. Okay, nice one.
I thought he was in like construction or something.
I don't got a clue what he was doing.
Oil worker.
He's just some sort of troubleshooter.
Yeah. Some keywords?
Yes, please.
Corruption.
Yeah, isn't that the truth?
Corporate greed.
Oh, Jesus Christ.
Eco-terrorism.
Yeah, not half.
Native American.
Plentiful.
Smelly reindeer.
Yes, that's one of my notes.
And of course, Ken's boxing nickname, the Cockney Texan.
Cool blimey, yeehaw! That's what I used to do.
A tagline for you?
Yep.
His battle to save the Alaskan wilderness and protect its people can only be won on deadly ground.
Okay. I thought that was going to be too long-winded, but I do like it when they lead you to the title.
Mm-hmm. This is one of many of his where it's like three or four words,
is.
Isn't it?
Yeah, is. I would have Steven Seagal is on deadly ground. Yeah. That would have done for me.
The poster's just him falling on ice skates or something. Him slipping over.
Yeah, he's on the bed of fire, isn't he? Just walking the fiery coals.
Yeah, like Ace Ventura.
Yeah, that's all he's doing.
The actual poster for this is a beauty. It's him holding a shotgun superimposed over like a fire happening, like an oil rig on fire, and then you see some firefighters and the
and
mountain.
He's got his jacket on, hasn't he?
He has. Oh, yeah, here we go.
I've got the DVD now. I'm just showing Dom. I think it's the Dutch version of it.
It is indeed. Look at that.
It's difficult to get, you see that.
Is it?
Yeah.
What, to actually get the DVD?
On DVD, yeah.
Yeah, he's airbrushed to the max there, isn't he?
I don't know. I think it looks good. It looks good in this one.
Yeah, well,
he's still okay, isn't he? In this one,
I mean, he's not
90s.
A cartoon character, but
yeah,
he's not
drawn on, is he?
No,
at least.
Fun fact for you, Ken: Steven Seagal agreed to appear in Under Siege 2 if Warner Brothers allowed him to direct this movie.
Fucking brilliant! I quite like Under Siege 2.
It's not the worst, to be honest. Are we cracking straight in, or do you want to have a little pre? Here's my thoughts on the film.
No, I fucking really enjoy this film.
Yeah,
It's just Steven Seagal, isn't it?
Yeah, I love this one.
He wanted to make this film.
This is him.
A lot. And you can tell.
Yeah, this is him coming out of his golden age of films. And this is sort of this and Under Siege 2 are sort of his going. We're at the beginning of the end.
His segue.
Yeah.
His segue out. What was the one he did before this then?
Under Siege.
Was it?
Yeah.
Oh, right. So this was the stopgap between the two.
Yeah. This was sort of the beginning of the end for Steve as a bankable action star.
Under Siege was like his biggest financial success, wasn't it? Or theatrical success, wasn't it?
It was, yeah.
And then he made this.
Yes.
A bit like us riding high on a crest of a wave and then throwing Forest Warrior in there.
Exactly.
Just to derail ourselves.
Just derailing the whole fucking show. Neither of us wanted to do it. We did it and no one listened to it.
Dom sent a message. I told him we finally got 100 downloads on that.
Absolutely pathetic.
It's taken a lot longer than the usual episodes. And Dom's response was, I hated watching it. I hated speaking about it. Nobody cares. And no one's listened to it. What a great choice. I was like, that was one of mine.
Yeah, one of Ken's. Night Trap, that wasn't even a film, got more listens than that fucking thing.
I'm glad you've mentioned that because I had a little check on the figures of that, and my birthday episode has surpassed yours, making me more popular. Hooray for me!
Yes, it's almost
thanks
as
everyone.
If Flash Gordon is more popular than Night Trap.
No. The stats are there, Dom. It's written there. It's written. I'm more popular than you.
This is what I'm dealing with. This is my co-host who checks whose birthday got more listens.
Making me the victor.
Anyway. Let's fucking start.
Let's laugh at Seagal for a bit.
It's alive. It's alive. It's alive.
What I do like, Ken, is when we start is in the credits, the opening credits, Steven Seagal's name is in there three times.
It is, yes. I wrote that down. Yeah, it's his first name we see. It's also the second name we see. And it's the third name we see.
It's a Seagal / someone else film. No,
it's a Steven Seagal film.
Yeah.
Then it's produced by Steven and two other people. And then I think we just go straight in with the star who bills himself above, I don't know if you've heard of him, Michael Caine.
It is insane to me.
Sir Michael Caine.
Insane to me that he is in this film. This
great.
Has got a crazy cast list of people.
It is, isn't it? It's a great cast.
Yeah, it is a good cast.
Sir Michael Caine there, co-starring to Big Steve.
And you can tell Seagal's directed this because the first thing you see is an eagle. Flying beautiful above the...
There will be plenty more of that if you want to hear more impressions of eagles. Although, as Monkeysmo pointed out, it's a hawk. Because the eagle's cry is too pathetic to be effective.
Interesting.
Thank you for that, Monkeysmo. One that we actually understood.
Yes, and then we get a beautiful showing of the Alaskan wilderness.
We do, don't we?
It is nice.
There's a bloody polar bear.
There is.
A polar bear just wandering about, big and bold as brass.
Yep, we get a helicopter, and then we see there's a fire.
There's a fire down below. And oh, no, that's a different one, isn't it?
It is.
That's his other eco film.
It is. I get that confused.
I often do. Yeah. I think everybody does, right, everyone? Yes.
I think initially we did say a fire down below, but then we were like, no, the Michael Caine one. We're like, oh, no, that's not that one.
No, it isn't. That's Chris Christopherson, I believe.
That is indeed. One. That's another one I like as well, to be fair. We see Foreman. His name's Hugh Palmer, played by Richard Hamilton, who was in Men in Black, if anyone remembers. At the beginning there, Tommy Lee Jones' first partner.
He's a bit fucking old, isn't he, to be doing this job, wouldn't you say?
Yes.
Wouldn't you think?
He is.
Wouldn't you think you'd perhaps try and like promote from within to sort of, you know, you could train somebody up and then just kind of retire?
Yeah, he is too old to be.
He looks late 70s.
Yeah.
What he's still doing hanging around bloody oil fields in the middle of Alaska, I don't know.
Well, in Men in Black, he's basically saying, I'm too old to do this shit.
Yeah.
He's like Danny Glover, but actually true.
But actually really old as
yeah.
well.
Yeah. And yeah, he's directing.
Danny Glover, when he said that, was younger than we are. Fucker.
Yeah,
bastard.
He's directing people around the place, telling them to put fires out. He sees the helicopter turning up and he says, oh, thank God. Because he knows on that helicopter, we get a snakeskin boot stepping out.
Oh, what a fucking pair of boots they are.
They are ridiculous.
I'd love to have those boots. They're incredible boots.
This eco-warrior's got snakeskin boots.
Yeah, because he likes everything except snakes. Yes. They make lovely boots.
Yeah.
Yeah, we pan up as well, don't we? We get the pan up and it's lovely. It's beautifully well done, I think, from Stephen.
Yeah.
For himself.
I said, like, if you thought that was the best thing about this attire, you'd be wrong. Because we pan up. And we see the jacket.
It's not long before we get to the jacket, because the jacket is very long.
Yeah.
It's almost where his boots would end. His jacket begins.
I think this is the first time in any of his films he's bringing in his Native American style that he wants to start. From now until like up to date, he's worn something Native American,
hasn't he? Quite outrageous.
Yeah. And here he's got this tasseled, frilly jacket.
It's brilliant, isn't it?
With, like, shit on the back.
Three-quarter length bloody tasseled jacket.
Yeah.
Yeah, with tribal patterns and design. It's great.
Yeah, the tribal
it's
on the back.
Fucking lovely.
It's funny. He lights a cigar, turns, big Steve Seagal.
There he is.
He plays Ken, what's his name? Great name.
Beautifully coated, beautifully named, Forrest Taft. And if you don't know his name, don't worry. He's got it written on everything he owns.
I made that note. He's like, it's on his car. It's on his jacket.
He's just flown in. How often's he there? Everyone fucking knows him as well. I don't know why he wasn't there in the first place, to be honest.
Yeah. He says, hey, you, what's cooking? To the old boy.
Are you not sure? He says Hugh. That's his name, isn't it? He didn't say, hey, you.
Oh.
Hey, Hugh.
You have a great story about that, don't you?
Hey, Hugh. Oh, yeah, in Gran Canaria.
Yes.
Yeah, I've got a friend called Hugh, and his surname's English. He's actually, like, it's a Welsh spelling of Hugh, which is irrelevant. And we were walking around Gran Canaria. We got split up. We were drunk and that. And he was walking around, and people kept coming up to him trying to sell him stuff. And their first words to him was, you English? And he'd be like, yeah. And he thought, how the fuck does everybody know who I am?
Pure English?
Yeah, and he was just like, yes! Like, really excited. He couldn't believe his luck. Everybody knew him.
Couldn't believe his luck.
And we were following some signs to get home, and it was like a, sort of like an arrow with a cigarette on it. We thought that was where we were staying.
Yeah.
And it turns out that it was just an advert for cigarettes, and they were fucking all over the place, pointing in different directions on every street corner. And we thought it was a way back to where we were staying. Oh, great days. And that's not even talking about the prostitutes I pushed in a hedge. That's a different story, which we'll come to perhaps one day.
Yeah, when we do Unspeakable.
Okay, yeah, we can, yeah, can't we? That's more prostitute-based.
Yeah, I've got a prostitute story as well, I can tell.
Oh, this is great.
Brilliant.
So to preempt that episode, anyone, if you've got a prostitute story and it's funny, perhaps.
Yeah, more than upsetting, if it's funny.
Yeah, please don't send in, it's not confession time. If you've got a funny story about prostitutes, send them in. Maybe we'll read them out to accompany ours.
It's alive!
Anyway, back to this.
He says, what's cooking? And Hugh says, God damn it, Forrest, this is a disaster.
Oh, no.
He tells Taft that the fire started due to shoddy equipment, and he blames your goddamn pal Jennings Lousy. And as he says that, the door to the helicopter he's just got out of opens up. And it's Michael Caine with dyed black hair.
Michael Caine's there.
Why has he dyed his hair?
It's oil, isn't it?
Oh, that's true.
He's an oil baron. Yeah, he loves oil, so he puts it on his hair.
Now he says, what did you just say, you old cunt? But when he does say that, Michael Caine I think for the first 10 minutes of this film, tries to do an accent.
I think he's American for about 10 minutes, isn't
yeah.
he?
Yeah, and then he just fucks that
and
off.
And then he thinks that's enough of that now.
Yeah, I'm Michael Caine.
You know I'm Michael Caine, so what's the point?
He looks at the camera and says that.
My name is Michael Caine.
Yeah. My name is Michael Jennings. Because he's still Michael in this.
Well, I don't know if it's supposed to be. We'll get to that point. Yes. Because nobody calls him that until I think Seagal forgets.
When I wrote that, I thought, has he just said that by mistake and he's left it in?
Because no one's ever used his first name until then. Yeah, so and he says, what the fuck are you talking about? And he says, oh, nothing, Mr. Jennings. And he goes, I fucking didn't think so, you fuck.
Yeah.
I fucking think so.
I didn't fucking think so. A lot of ADR in this as well. People off camera shouting things into the scene.
I like that as well.
This is very Prometheus, I'm getting.
I enjoyed that bit.
There's some great ones that get shouted out that you have to listen out for. As he's walking up to the fire now, all you hear is like, hey, Forrest is here.
Yeah, that fire's as good as out. Hooray!
Who the fuck would ever say that?
Thank God!
That fire's as good as out, buddy!
Thank God, Forrest is here. Yay! Yeah, that kind of thing. You know, like when you have other fights where he just goes, ow, you broke my nose. You know, like where he does that in other films. Yeah, that's like this, but fucking maximum.
There's one of them in this as well, isn't there?
Very much so.
He takes Big Steve over to the crane that's been packed full of explosives just the way he likes it.
Mm.
And then fucking John C. McGinley, my old pal.
Yeah, he turns up.
He plays Magruder.
Magruder, I think it is.
Magruder.
Yeah.
Magruder, he's like the second-hand man to Jennings, and I fucking love me some John C. McGinley.
Yeah, I often think that it's John C. Reilly. I get him confused, but it's not.
No.
It's McGinley.
Yeah, that's true, that is.
Thanks.
To start off with, Forrest doesn't believe what Q is saying, asking why would they want to blow up his own oil rig or something like that.
It does not make sense. Why would he put faulty equipment in his own oil rig that would eventually mean they have to blow it up?
Yeah.
It's a fair point at this point, at this moment in the film. It's a fair point made there by Forrest Taft.
Yeah. Hugh says, you used to be a good man, Forrest. Now you're nothing but a whore.
It's shocking.
That is shocking.
I was shocked by that. I had to turn it off.
Just called Steven Seagal a whore.
Yeah. Well, Seagal is not that bothered, is he? Because he replies with, for 350 grands, I'd fuck anything once.
Including you old man.
Hugh.
Including Hugh. Including you, Hugh.
Hugh. Barney McGrew. Yeah, Barney, he's behind him. He's like, huh? Me? Would you, for that money, would you fuck anything once for 350K?
Depends what it is. If it was like a bacon slicer, then no.
Oh, yeah. I don't know if he's including that.
I think he is.
He does say anything, doesn't he?
Yeah.
I wouldn't then. No. What about...
Would you fuck an electric pencil sharpener?
Oh, no. I'm getting one of those.
You would. I've heard the rumours.
Oh, bloody pencil dick.
Yeah.
Old needle dick, Kenneth.
He's got no grippage.
The grippage. Yeah, you're right. Probably not, then. What about... do you think he means inanimate? Or do you think he means, like, at least animate objects? Is animate? It doesn't sound right without in front of it.
No.
So do you think he means like
living
beasts?
Beasts of the earth and land and fish. It, yeah. Land and sea.
That's the things, yeah.
Do you reckon he'd fuck a dolphin?
I think he would. And its bloody spout.
Is this the game we're playing? What do we think Steven Seagal will fuck for $350,000?
Well, he likes animals, doesn't he?
So I think likes snakes.
Oh, no. Well, he likes their boots. Could you fuck a snake? You'd have to go mouth, wouldn't you? You'd have to go straight. That's the danger end of the snake, surely.
I'm going to say no, you can't.
In the mouth?
It's a snake Plissken.
Oh, yeah, in his eye. Yeah. His eye socket.
Why do you think he's wearing the eye patch?
Seagal's fucked him for 350 grand.
Yeah.
It's alive!
He lights his cigarette on the burning building, presses a button and blows the fucking place
up. Yeah, this is where he puts his overalls on. He's got his name on the back.
Yeah.
Fucks about for a bit. Says get back. Everyone ducks, except Big Steve.
Yeah.
Steven Seagal just stands there whilst that explosion blows shit even past him up. So how he's not dead from that, we don't know, but it looks great.
Mm-hmm.
I'll tell you who else doesn't duck.
Michael Caine.
Michael Caine. He don't give a fuck about that.
No.
No, everybody else does, including your mate, John C. Magruder.
Yeah.
He ducks, but no one else. Yeah, just the two of them standing there, eyeballing each other.
Cool guys don't look at explosions.
Well, Michael Caine's facing it, but I expect he's looking at Seagal.
Mm.
Wondering if it was him that fucked his pet snake.
Pliskin. Yeah. Jennings tells him how impressive he is, which
if,
I like.
If I had a snake, I'd call it Pliskin, wouldn't you? That's a good name. Anyway, he does, yes. He says, as always, doesn't he? He tells him he's done a great job, as always.
Yep.
Thus building the character of Forrest Taft for the viewer.
They both fly off together, in a helicopter, of course, not just...
the snowman. Takes his hand and they fuck off.
Father Flying Bear.
Forrest Taft. Away!
Fucking hell!
Yeah, that's not happened. That's a bit later on. It's in the deleted scenes on the DVD. That's right, it's difficult to get.
No, he doesn't fly off. But when they get in the helicopter... Sven Ole Thorsen's in there.
He is, isn't he?
What the hell?
Secundus. Secundus is there, pretending to not be from space.
I'm sure he wasn't in this film when I last watched it. I think he's jumped in.
That's what happens, you see. He messes with time and space. And yeah, he is. He's in it. It's good to see him back.
It is. He plays Otto.
Yeah, doesn't speak much, does he, in this?
No.
No, I think he only gets like a couple of lines. But still, it's always good to see him.
Yeah. Seagal's like, last time I saw you, you were fighting that really muscly monk from the future.
Yeah, you were punching that headmaster in the face.
Jennings tells Forrest that he wants to finger the old man he just met.
Yeah, he'd do anything for $350,000. Yeah. Finger anything once.
He's saying it was human error that caused the fire, not the company's machinery, and he blames Hugh. Not you, Hugh.
Oh, thank you.
You're pointing at yourself there. He says Hugh has to take the finger in or Jennings will have Eskimos and environmentalists probing him every which way but loose.
Yeah, probing every orifice for the next 2 weeks.
Yeah.
What is he talking about? That's not how those investigations go, is it?
I think so.
Is it?
It is. When you're dealing with the Inuits.
That's how they probe.
Yeah.
With fingers.
Yes.
You know, this is a very close to my heart, this film, because I am one of the protesters of Just Say No to Oil.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, I like to do that in my spare time. Just go and put like orange stuff on other stuff.
Oh, yeah.
And that gets the message across. It's more powerful than anything else.
Yeah, I think there's nothing that proves that more than throwing paint on Stonehenge.
Yes, yes. Well, you know, oil.
Yeah.
Isn't it? You don't make Stonehenge without oil.
That's true.
And the snooker. You know, the snooker tournaments, those vile oil-based snooker tournaments.
Yeah.
Yeah, that'll teach them.
Well, it serves them right.
And paintings as well. Paintings from like the late 15th century. Yes, that really annoyed me, that did. Weren't they thinking of us here in the future when they made those artistic pieces of masterwork?
We'd all be like Adam and Eve still running around naked if they hadn't made those paintings.
Yeah. That's right, and that's why I like to throw paint on them.
Yeah, that's
other
fair
paint,
enough,
non-oil-based paint is what I use,
or soup.
Sometimes soup.
Yeah,
yeah. No oil in soup.
That's true.
Unless that's what my T-shirt says.
And that's the bad movie called Guarantee. When you buy our range of soups,
no oil.
Yeah.
No crude oil.
No crude oil in our.
Oh no, sir.
In our cream of mushroom.
Oh no, no, no. Obviously, it's different if you go oxtail. But you know, we're not mentioning that.
Obviously,
yeah. It's not
that
all
goes
of
without
them.
Saying.
It's not all of them.
Yeah.
Would you fucking oxtail?
I don't know what that is.
It's a arse end of an ox, isn't it?
Really? They just make soup out just
of its buttocks.
Would you cut your own buttocks off and make soup with it?
For $350,000 or just for fun?
Either.
Yeah. One of them. I'd only cut one of them off.
Yeah. How many arses have you got?
Too much soup. No, one buttock.
Okay. Yeah.
Yeah.
Too much soup.
Too much soup, isn't it, for both?
Yeah.
I'll never sell it all.
Taft reassures him and he says, I kind of blew up all the evidence.
Oh, yeah. And he goes, oh, yeah. Thanks.
Thanks a lot, geezer. And then they hug. That night at the bar.
What a scene that we've just jumped straight to now.
Yeah.
Why? Hang on. Why did he have to be flown in anyway to make that?
He had to press the button.
Yeah, Why was it him?
He had to put his suit on with his name on the back and then press the button that the old boy handed to him.
Yeah, that said there's the button to blow everything up. Nice suit.
That's it, yeah.
Okay.
That's why he was flown in.
Okay, fair enough then.
Yeah, they're at the bar. And this, for me, either this or Out for Justice has got the best bar fight scene for me for Seagal.
It's Out for Justice, to be honest with you, Tom.
Yeah.
That's the one that's better. That one.
I don't know, Ken.
Oh, come on.
This is more iconic.
I don't know. This is more fucking ridiculous. I'll give you that.
Exactly.
I'll give you that.
This is more Seagal.
This is the classic scene that you probably know and love as the cupcake scene.
Yes. I think that...
You think this is better?
No, what I think is that any action hero could have done the Out for Justice one. Only Seagal could have done this one.
Oh, I suppose. I suppose.
Yes, as Ken says, everyone knows this as the cupcake scene. We're at the bar, Tafty's alone, he's watching Mike Starr.
Yeah, Big Mike.
Big Mikey, who's the henchman from Dumb and Dumber, you might remember him from that. And he's just being a racist dickhead to a Native American who's had a few too many drinks and walks past him. And if there's one thing that you know not to do around Big Steve, it's to take the piss out of a Native American.
Or anyone, really. Anyone, you know, bullying, I think, is the key, isn't it? He doesn't like bullying.
You know that.
Yeah.
Alligator.
That's what he's thinking. Little thought bubble. There's some sick shit up in here, alligator.
Mike Starr says,
Hey, don't bust my balls, I'm warning you.
Right, buy you a drink?
Listen to me, you yellow snow eating, welfare collecting, redskin piece of shit. Get the fuck out of here!
It's a long-winded, isn't it?
That's a lot.
It's too much, really, isn't it?
Yeah, he'd have walked off by then.
Yeah,
wouldn't he?
He'd have just not heard him at all.
He's carried on because he's drunk.
And then he's the classic bully where he says things, and then he looks around and laughs, and all of his friends are laughing. So just to make sure that they're all entertained by him, you know.
And then he turns towards Seagal, who's watching this with a very stern look.
Yeah, in his frill jacket. He's got that back on.
Yeah, and he says, "Hey, cupcake. What are you looking at?" "Nothing much at all."
Oh, he whispers back. He's like, "What?"
Yeah, so we're at the other end of the bar, mate. So
fucking hell, you say something there, what?
Yeah, he went a bit Pierce Brosnan with that delivery, didn't he?
"Nothing much at all." What?
I think he said something. So, I saw his mouth move.
I don't know.
Yeah. And he gets up. Gets called a pussy as he passes by.
Yeah, he just is a bit tense, isn't it? As he thinks he's something's going to happen. And everyone's just like... And then nothing happens. He just walks straight past him, sits down in a different seat.
Yeah.
And he's like...
Pussy.
Says Mike.
And then Hugh turns up.
Me?
Old Hugh turns up.
All right.
And apologises for calling him a whore.
Good job he did change seats. He wouldn't have found him over there, would he?
No.
He'd perhaps have been pushed around by Big Mike.
He says, "You got one thing wrong. I'm not a good man," says Seagal.
Oh, yes.
But Forrest Taft. Hugh reminds him that the fire killed four of his men, including Forrest's pal, Lorenzo.
No, not Lorenzo.
Never mentioned ever again.
No. That's because he's dead.
Yeah.
You know, didn't like bringing it up. He was his pal.
Old Hugh asks him to do him a favour. He wants him to go into the company's archives to check out the requisition files of the oil rig to help prove Hugh's innocence.
What was it? It was faulty preventers, wasn't it? Faulty preventers. Imagine having something that prevents everything exploding and just calling them preventers.
Yeah.
Nice.
Well, at least we understand what they're talking about.
Well, I didn't. I had to look it up.
No.
It means to stop.
Seagal says he left his day pack and some weapons up at Hugh, so he's going to swing by and pick them up and go up into the hills. Again, classic, needless line, but Seagal wants you to know that he's a man of the wilderness.
Yeah, and he's got weapons.
Many weapons.
Somewhere in, like, that's not his house.
Yeah.
You know, if he's got a house over there.
You don't see it, unless it's that shack later on.
I don't know.
Start halfway up the mountain.
Fucking live there.
He's on 350 grand a year for fucking things. He's not going to be living in that shack, is he?
Only once.
Only so one off payment.
Wonder what he charges for second visit. The old sloppy seconds from Stephen.
Hugh says, "You know where they are," and then he leaves. Meanwhile, Mike Starr just cannot leave him alone.
He's fucking at it again, isn't he?
Unbelievable. When he walked past, you did not think, fucking hell, he's 6'7", this man.
Yeah, because he did seem to be a bit panicky, didn't he? But then he walked off and he got his confidence back.
Yeah, and he's just smiling at him. He's turned fully around in his seat. If you're his mate, you're thinking, mate, just fucking leave it.
Leave it. Leave it. Let's just have a drink.
Yeah.
Like, that's what we were doing.
Turns around and he calls him Cupcake again and asks if his boyfriend's left him. It's a dangerous game he's playing here, Ken.
Well, he pays the price, in fairness.
Because he belittles the Native American. He's standing by the jukebox.
Yeah, he calls him over. He just won't leave it alone, Big Mike.
Yeah.
What's wrong with this? He's fucking insane, this guy.
He offers him a beer and the Native American reaches for it. And as he reaches for it, he pulls it away and they all start laughing at him. He's like, no, go on. And as he reaches for it again, he just fucking throws the beer in his face. And that's enough for Taft.
Somebody shouts from the like off screen.
That's my uncle.
Somebody shouts, leave him alone, dickhead. Yeah. It's like, huh? It's a bit of a risk, isn't it? If he's doing his bullying,
yeah.
He just shouts it from a distance and then hides again thinking, I hope he didn't know that was me.
Yeah, that's enough for Taft, who proceeds to beat the absolute shit out of 14 men.
Yep, he's up, and it's a fight.
And as I say, for my money, one of the most iconic scenes in any Seagal film.
We get, there's a bit of arm snapping,
yeah,
isn't there? You get some rope wrapping.
He
gets a rope and then wraps it around people and stuff, like uses that to smash them into things.
He kills two men with this ornate rope that is just hanging off like a fucking lasso.
Yeah, the
kicks one in the bollocks.
Yeah, he's got some ball grabbing. He does a bit of that where he actually lifts somebody up off the ground with his balls.
Yeah. I like, because you were on about earlier about when someone breaks their nose, they're like, oh, you've broke my nose. This guy just goes, my nuts! As he fucking grabs
That's a lot of nuts!
That's what Steve says.
Some glass smashing, obviously. Classic. We're smashing the glass. We're throwing people through glass.
Mike Starr watches Taft beat up everyone else in the bar, then decides to tell him how big his own balls are.
He even beats up two elderly men, doesn't he, Stephen?
I've written that. I've written he's pummeled an old man to the ground there.
He doesn't look much younger than old Hugh.
But
he's like fucking near retirement. Probably just trying to get to the toilet. Steven Seagal's just broke his arm and smashed his face into the floor.
I thought Forrest Taft doesn't take it easy on you just because you're in your 80s. There's one old man that's walking past. He just fucking breaks his leg.
He does, yeah. He just fucking kicks his leg straight through. It's like, Jesus, man. I just need a piss.
Yeah, so Mike Starr starts talking about his own balls and how big they are.
Yeah, he's got a big, big old pair of balls. That's because Forrest asks him, are you a man?
How big are your balls?
And he says, yeah, and he looks it up. His comparison to Hulk Hogan's cock and balls, of course.
Yes, or Terry Bollea. That's...
Well, yeah, it's different though, isn't it?
Did you use your balls to beat up on this little native man, he says.
That's... He says, no, of course not. What?
It's demeaning,
how
isn't it?
How would I do that?
Like how he talked, did you use those to beat up on this pathetic little native
on this man? Useless idiot.
Yeah.
How would you use your big balls to beat up on somebody else? You'd have to be swinging them.
I was going to say, momentum.
Wouldn't you? Yeah.
Yeah.
Like a little Newton's cradle. Maybe knocking him off of somebody else's balls.
Yeah.
Create that momentum and eventually knock him over.
And this is where we get the hand slap game scene.
Fucking hell. Somebody else. This guy don't have a fucking clue. Off screen. He's like, what? Who? Who are you talking about?
Not Hugh. He's
no,
gone.
No. It was Hugh. He's left.
Yeah, we get the hand slap game. Typical sort of kids game of hand slap. If Taft misses, then Big Balls gets a shot at him. But if Big Balls misses, then Taft gets a shot at him.
Yeah, yes.
Three hits.
Yeah, that's pretty much the game. Except it's a very one-sided game that he doesn't even have a go, does he?
I put, for some reason, Big Balls agrees. And I'll say again, and we say this every time we do a Seagal film, in the book Seagalogy...
by Vern.
A study of the ass-kicking films of Steven Seagal by Vern, one of the gifts, one of the many gifts that Ken showered me with...
What? about me showering you with things, though.
Since we've been friends, and this is one of the best things he's ever got me. If you love Steven Seagal, Seagalology by Vern, you really need to pick it up. It's absolutely superb. And Vern says, now, just a little hint for all of you bullies out there, or anybody who finds themselves in a situation like Big Mike finds himself in here. Generally speaking, if you're fighting a guy and he offers to play a silly children's game of some kind, there's going to be some kind of catch.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, it sounds like it would be easy to slap a guy's hands, but why the fuck do you think he suggested this? because he's good at not getting his hand slapped. Unfortunately for Big Mike, he must have a big ego when it comes to his hand slapping skills. And that's true. If Steven Seagal offers to play a fucking game of something with you, you know for a fact he's not going to lose the game. So why would you do it?
You know, in Hard to Kill, where he throws his gun away and gets on his knees and says, right, come at me with a knife and cut my heart out.
Yeah.
He'd be there thinking,
no,
I don't know about this now. Yeah. It's kind of put me a little bit on edge. Maybe he's good at something. But still, he has a go and he gets his arm snapped as well and his leg broken, doesn't he? So, you know, maybe Big Mike's never seen Hard to Kill.
Yeah.
Perhaps not up in the mountains.
There's lots of saying about man. Oh, he's a man now. He's got big balls. Oh, come at me, man. Aren't you a man?
Yeah, he does say that quite often there, doesn't he? Too many times, I would say.
Yeah, the crowd are lapping it up. And punches him in the stomach, knocks him to the ground.
Yeah, it's because he misses his hands, doesn't he? He moves them. He slaps Big Mike's hands. He's too quick. He's underneath, isn't he? Seagal's hands are underneath. Big Mike's are on top. And he just whips him and slaps him.
Yeah.
Ooh, he's quick.
Does it again. Second punch knocks him to the ground, makes him throw up.
Yeah, somebody actually also off camera shouts, come on, big balls.
That was me.
I wondered who it was.
Yeah.
I did have a look actually in the garden and you'd gone.
After the third knockdown, we get one of the most left field and iconic lines from any Seagal film.
First of all, he accuses Big Mike of eating halibut.
Oh, yeah, when he throws up,
he says, ooh. He actually does a noise like, ooh.
He does that twice in this film.
He does, yes. I've got that later as well. What is that? Halibut.
Yeah.
Is that halibut?
Yeah.
He says.
Yeah. That's how he pronounces it as well.
Yeah. Why are you not eating oxtail soup full of oil and Ken's buttocks?
As I say, it's the most left field and iconic line from any Seagal film. It comes out of nowhere. If this wasn't Seagal, you would be like, what the fuck is this? But it kind of fits. As Big Ball stands up and he's covered in blood, his nose is fucked, Seagal hits us with the line, Ken.
What does it take to change the essence of a man? He's like, what?
Yeah, everyone's like,
I'm sorry, what the fuck are you on about now?
What does it take? What does it take to change the essence of a man? I need time to change. Time. I do too. I do too.
It's an amazing scene.
Yeah, if you could ask an AI to say, write a Steven Seagal bar fight, it'd just write that, because that is absolutely perfect.
It doesn't make any sense whatsoever. And as he's walking off, that Native American, he puts his arm around the Native American guy, who decides to say to him, you must go on a sacred journey, which will be good for all people.
Yeah.
And he's just like, whatever. You bloody idiot. And leaves.
The next day, Jennings is doing an environmental commercial to help his image after the recent oil spill.
Yeah, he's on damage limitation, isn't he?
He speaks to the director, who's talking him through how he wants the scene to be shot. And Jennings says, listen, if you have any great ideas, just keep them to your fucking self, okay? And leave this shit to me.
Of course, you know who that is, yeah?
Yes.
The director?
I do, yes.
It's Irvin Kershner, of all people.
Yep, directed The Empire Strikes Back, one of the Bond films.
Never Say Never Again, which I think is when he met Seagal.
Yeah, that's why he's in the film, right?
Yeah, yeah. RoboCop 2, he directed as well.
Mm.
So it's like a bit of a joke there that he would say all this. And it's like Michael Caine just telling him, you know, you don't know shit compared to me. I'm Michael fucking Caine.
You don't know shit about halibut.
You fuck a halibut for $350,000?
Let us know, badmoviecall@gmail.com.
Yeah, we'd ask Irvin Kershner, but unfortunately he died.
Oh. Caine does a great job of playing this dickhead bigwig suit, I've put. You know, you can flip
he
from
do,
being
he,
this
he
dickhead.
He does seem to be like having fun, doesn't he?
Yeah. And when they interviewed him about it, people were saying, like, oh, is it true that you, Seagal, were not getting on? And he said, no, it was fine. He just didn't like the weather in Alaska when they were doing the scenes up there. But I think at that point, this was the point in Michael Caine's career where he was just doing any old shit. Sort of 80s to 90s, he was doing whatever, wasn't he? But in this scene, in this film, I think Michael Caine's really, really good in this film.
I think he is as well.
And he can go from this horrible fucking ranting and raving suit to this bit now where the cameras turn on and he's this loving guy talking about the animals.
Overly sickly sweet, isn't he?
Yeah.
Which I did. I like that as well.
Yeah, and as soon as the cameras stop rolling, he berates the reindeer for smelling. He demands a wet wipe. So Ken comes out. he then discusses business with his secretary called Lyles.
Yeah, he goes into like Scrooge overdrive now, doesn't he? It's like his precursor to the Muppets, this is. After it, I don't know when it was done. But where he says he's got to go.
It can't be much longer after this.
I don't know.
I think 99 maybe.
Does look older in Muppets, doesn't he? But could have been the classic Max von Sydow thing.
Yeah, he got the old boot polish on his head. That's why.
Oh yeah, of course.
You know, I'd bet like Muppet Christmas Carol's like a year after this. No, it can't be. It's got to be a bit more, hasn't it? 3-4 years. I'd say like Muppet Christmas Carol got to be like 98, 97.
What was this? 94. Oh, let's have a fucking look, shall we? Fucking 92. This was before Muppet Christmas Carol. Was before this.
Muppet Christmas Carol was 1992.
It was the very, very film before this film. So he did Muppet Christmas Carol, then went straight to this.
Right, that's why he's wearing a wig in it then.
And that'll be why he's.
He'd have scared the kids if he'd have had that jet black hair.
And that'll be why he's so good. And that's what must have reminded me of Scrooge.
Yes.
Straight in.
Fuck it. It's like Michael Caine, you. Bloody lunatic. God bless you. Retired now.
Well, fair enough.
He is 90.
He doesn't need the fucking money, does he?
It's alive. It's alive. It's alive.
Yeah, he discusses business with his secretary, Lyles, who's played by Shari Shattuck.
She's been in a few things as well, hasn't she?
She has, yeah. I've seen her in a few things.
She's confusingly attractive.
Really? I just assumed... Well, I didn't assume. I thought just attractive.
Yeah, okay then. That's what I meant.
Yeah.
Not conventionally, unconventionally attractive, then, I would say.
Oh, really? I just thought she was attractive.
That's fair enough, then. She's attractive, isn't she? She's an attractive lady. Yeah.
Considering you'd fuck a halibut, Ken, I don't think you can you could say anything about how attractive.
No disrespect to her.
Or halibut.
You need to be bringing that in.
And also, Magruder's there, old Johnny C. Here he is. Even Lyles gets a bit of dialogue as well to prove how evil she is. She just seems like a sort of business lawyer or something. But she says to Michael Caine as they're on the move, she says that the payments to the bereaved family members of the oil workers who died in that explosion, including poor Lorenzo, the payment was overly generous. So Michael Caine's like, this is why I want to have sex with you.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Lower the payments to however you see fit.
Perfect. It also gives us the Aegis One,
yeah,
which is his main oil platform. That needs to be up and running in 2 weeks, or they lose it to the goddamn Eskimos.
Yeah, this is the plot.
So this is the plot brought back in. That's why I thought I'd mention it.
Yeah,
not all slapping hands and halibut.
Yeah, he's got 13 days to start drilling, or billions of dollars a week is lost, and gives it back to the Inuits. Lyles also tells him that there's been a whistleblower complaining about the faulty equipment that caused the fires. And Jennings, he knows exactly who it was. Hugh.
No, it wasn't me at all. I don't know shit about dick.
You don't know dick about fuck.
I don't know fuck about cunt.
I don't need that kind of problem right now.
Nor do I.
Then he turns to John McGinley and he says, "You're the people I hire to get rid of these kind of problems." Back at the rig, this is Aegis One we're at. Taffy turns up. He's got a fucking car with his name on it.
On both sides as well.
Yeah.
Both doors, both front doors. Yeah. I thought it would just be on the one that he was sat at. There's a side that he was, you know, the driver's side. But nope. Just in case you're out on the passenger side, you're also known as Forrest Taft.
Goes into the computer room, gets on there, sends Hugh the information he's been asking for.
It's got faulty preventers. Yeah. In fact, it's faulty fucking everything by the look of it. It's like everything he looks at just comes up flashing red, saying danger, danger, high voltage.
And he's like, Lord have mercy.
Lord, sweet Lord. Yeah, he has a look, and apparently what it would have been a 90-day delay to get the correct equipment. So, you know, a little light bulb moment for Forrest. He knows that is why the faulty preventers were used.
Yeah.
Because it would have delayed things and then, you know, it lost money. Inuits get all that shit back.
Yep, and as he's sending that to Hugh, there's a call for Magruder, and the IT guys are on it straight away and lets him know that Forrest Taft's logged in and sending documents out from their network to someone else. Magruder tells Jennings this, and Jennings sends him to find the information Hugh's been gathering.
Yeah, he does. He does say that he's volunteering to go and take care of Forrest Taft personally, and he says, "No, go and fucking take care of a very old man first.
Yeah,
that's the main priority." So he says, "Roger that."
Magruder and Otto, so Sven Ole Thorsen,
Big Sven.
They go to Hugh's home, and Hugh's there. He's downloading shit, and all of a sudden, he's blocked out from the mainframe. They ask Hugh to come with them. Jennings wants to meet him and wants to talk over some shit, and then Hugh refuses. And also, this is where it gets nasty. And I actually think John McGinley in this is really good in this scene.
Yeah, I think he's quite good.
And they tie him to the table and basically end up torturing him by smashing each one of his fingers with a... He's got some sort of decorative whalebone fucking thing on his desk. And Sven Ole Thorsen uses that to smash each one of his fingers.
Smash his fingers one at a time.
Whilst they're looking for it. And he still doesn't...
He ain't telling them shit.
No. So Magruder, he finds this... is a pipe cutter.
It's a pipe cutter, yeah.
Yeah. Hugh, yeah, he's tortured. He refused to give up his information. And he's fucking killed. How about that?
Well, yeah. That's not, we don't get to see that at all on the DVD or anything.
No.
I double checked to see if it was cut, but it's not. You just don't get to see it.
No.
It's a shame, really. Because it's quite a violent film, really. There's lots of violence coming up.
There's an absolutely superb bit of violence.
But we don't get to see that. Probably because it's an old man. It's not very nice.
No. We get a press conference. Lyle's trying to placate the media, saying no lasting harm will have happened due to the recent oil spill. They're still doing a sort of, what's it called? What did you say earlier?
Damage limitation.
Damage limitation, absolutely. There's a spokesman for the local Inuit tribe, the local Inuit tribal council.
Mm-hmm.
He interrupts Jennings as he's walking off, saying they demand answers for the pollution that's affecting the lives of Inuits, including their women who are failing to ovulate. And when they do, they give birth to abnormal babies.
Mm.
Jennings gets all up in this guy's face until a young...
He's a very small man, isn't he? The guy whose face he gets in, because he actually gets down into his face.
Yeah.
Because he has to sort of duck down.
And then there's a young lady that shoves past Seagal, who's wearing a different jacket, but still...
Yeah. Still very frilly, isn't it?
Yeah, still beautiful. Shoves past him and throws a cup full of oil over... Michael Caine's new suit.
Yeah, it's pretty shit, isn't it? He doesn't go very far. Oil's very thick, isn't it?
Yeah,
and viscous, so you can't really throw oil at somebody. It's kind of like a drip thing. So yeah. She does try. It messes up a little bit of his suit, but you know, it's pathetic, really, isn't it? It's a pathetic demonstration. Still, you know, he's not happy. He's like, "What is it? It's oil." It's, oh, thank God.
Yeah,
he's not fucking bothered about oil, is he? He's got it all in his hair.
Yeah, exactly, yeah. Taft, as they're walking off, he starts to question Jennings, saying that he understands why he's using faulty equipment, because if he waits until the next shipment of parts, they'll never make the deadline to start drilling.
Yeah, he just comes out and just plainly admits that he's been doing a bit of snooping.
Yeah.
Using the word snooping.
And Taft asks him, how much is enough?
Mm-hmm.
How much money is enough?
He actually says, I'm a little bit ashamed of you.
Yeah.
Like he expects that to be enough for Michael Caine to rethink his values. It's much as he did in Muppet Christmas Carol 2 years earlier.
Well, he's like, I'm ashamed of you. Have you not seen the fucking jacket you're wearing?
He's like, ooh, burn.
And your fucking little ponytail.
Yeah, and a little tear comes to Stephen's eye.
We use the same oil in our hair, at least. I'd love to have seen the prequel to this, where they go to Bangkok. Michael Caine and Seagal.
Yeah, more on that in a bit.
Jennings, he doesn't respond when asked how much is enough and about the orders. And he says he asks Taft to do one last job before he answers his questions.
For old time's sake.
And for some insane reason, Taft agrees.
Yeah, there's another danger, isn't there? There's a danger on the other side. Another bloody rig.
Another, substation, isn't it?
Yeah, it looks like it's some danger going on. You need to get there and sort it out, because you're the only man who can.
Yep, so they take him to an abandoned oil refinery in the helicopter. It's Taft, it's Michael Caine, it's Jennings, whatever his name is, and then it's also Magruder.
Magruder, yeah. Taft, he goes in, he has a look round, he's thinking, what the hell? There's just explosives taped to the walls of everything.
He's all suited up.
Looks down. Bloody you.
Me?
Yeah. On the floor with no balls.
Oh, not again.
No balls, no arms, and one leg.
Yeah.
Classic night out for Dom.
Yeah. And Taft says, are you all right?
Lord have mercy.
They'd have killed Seagal if John McGinley didn't dick around with the fucking remote once Michael Caine gave it to him. He's like, let you do the honours, and John McGinley nearly shits.
Yep, he does. Very excited.
Presses the button. Explosion. Nice explosion, to be fair.
Yeah, yeah. There's quite a few explosions in this film.
Yeah. And then you see...
more than any other film ever.
And then you see Seagal's body go flying through the air.
Yeah, it's a great body in an explosion.
Yeah,
that
it's
is,
really good.
I really like that, flying through the bloody air with the greatest of ease.
Later on, because they're all like patting each other on the back, job well done, let's fly off. Later on, we see a tribe of Inuits.
I think Michael Caine actually looks away from this explosion.
Does he?
Yeah, I think he does, yeah.
Well, he's cool, isn't he?
No, but he looks away. He does, though, look away
cool,
on this one.
Cool guys don't look at explosions,
no,
Ken.
He looks like as if to say, fucking hell, that's a big explosion. That kind of look away, not just casually glancing in the other direction.
He's just like, giving the thumbs up to the camera.
No, it's bloody heads down, shit. That's a massive explosion kind of thing.
Heads down and shit.
Right, that's how you do it out in Alaska.
Yep, we get a tribe of Inuits. They're out on their dog sleds, and they notice smoke rising in the distance.
Yeah, bloody polar bear out there again. We get another shot of a polar bear for no reason.
They do look terrifying, don't they, polar
they're
bears?
Fucking massive. They look lovely and cute, but they're fucking enormous, and they will rip you to pieces, though.
Yeah, I think it's, is it black fight back, brown lay down, white good night? So basically, like, if you...
that sounds sexy.
Yeah. So it's like if you get attacked by a polar bear, you're just fucked, basically.
Yes, yeah. It has no fear of man.
Yeah, because it's
actively,
not natural.
It will actively hunt man.
Yeah.
Because it doesn't know what the fuck it is.
Yeah.
So it will just eat it, just hunt it and kill it, whereas other animals tend to avoid human contact.
Mm.
Polar bear will not. It will follow you and kill you when it can.
Excellent.
Thank you.
So, yeah, the Inuits, they turn up. There's some old fuck on the sled, and he says that the spirit of the man-bear lives within the smoke.
Yeah, and they're like, what?
He's seen it in his visions.
Yeah. Smoke in the distance, spirit of man-bear.
Do-do-do-do-do-do.
That's what he sings.
Yeah. They find Taft face down, arse out, in the snow there.
Yeah, it's how I'm often found. after a weekend.
Classic night out for Ken.
Yeah, but the eagle cries. We get another eagle cry in the wilderness.
Yeah, Don Henley was very upset.
Not surprised.
They pick him up and they take him back to their village. Another press conference.
Fucking hell, Caine.
Yeah.
Or Jennings, sorry.
Jennings. He says that substation 101 blew up as a result of sabotage by Forrest Taft and Hugh Palmer.
He says, listen, all of y'all, this is sabotage.
Yeah. I can't stand it. I know they planned it.
That's what McGinley says.
Yeah. He takes a swipe at the Inuit Council as well for using the explosions as a publicity tool. He's fucking sly, this boy.
He is, isn't he? He's got an answer for everything.
Yeah. Back at the village, Taft, he's looking good for a man who's just been in a massive explosion.
I've written that something from Labyrinth is trying to feed him something.
Dark crystal.
He's like, what the fuck is that?
Yeah.
Anyway, it's all insults aside, it's an old Inuit lady. But fucking hell, she doesn't look real.
It's Zelda.
She looks like a puppet.
Zelda from, is it Terra Hawks?
It looks horrible.
Yeah, he wakes up. There's an old woman. She's chewing food, spitting it out into her hand and trying to feed it to him.
Yeah, and even Steven Seagal won't eat that.
No.
Out of everybody, you'd think he would.
For $350,000, he would.
No, that's not what he does for that money.
Remember when you woke up and found me doing that to you?
Yeah.
Just eating food and spitting it into your mouth.
I did the same reaction as Steven Seagal, where he just goes, ew.
Yeah.
I'm like fucking Ernest. When he eats eggs erroneous, and Ernest goes to camp. Ooh.
And if you think this thing can get any more ridiculous...
In comes a guy dressed as a bird.
starts
pecking around the fucking place.
It's like something hopping into the scene. I'm like, what the fuck's that? And it's a man with dressed as a fucking raven.
Oh, Jesus.
And also the girl who threw the all over Jennings earlier, she's there.
Yep, Joan Chen, incidentally.
Yep. The guy dressed as a raven is the father of the girl. He is Chief Siluk. And her name is Meizu.
Nice.
It looks maybe 20 years old. I've put, do you think Seagal will try and have sex with her?
Mm-hmm. More on that later. And I think he'd do this one for free.
Taff thanks him for saving him, and Meizu translates for her father, saying that it was nothing. He thought Taft was a bear.
Do you know, she may as well not bother to translate it, because none of this makes sense in English or any fucking language.
He says, though you might still be a bear. He hasn't decided yet.
Yeah. And then he says, tell him I'm a mouse hiding from the hawks in the house of a raven. And she says, what? What? And she does. And then he also says, what the fuck is he talking about? Which is translated back as bear.
Yeah.
Or something like that. But what the fuck is Taft on about here?
I don't know. I put absolutely fucking ridiculous rubbish.
I love it. It's a great line. It's like the fucking Game of Thrones kind of nonsense, isn't it, that?
And that's another thing that separates Seagal. You only hear Arnie saying that stuff.
Tell him I am a mouse hiding from the hawks in the house of a raven. He's like, what?
Sorry?
Doesn't matter. Fuck it.
Tell him I'm a mouse? Hiding from the hawks.
Hiding.
In the house of the raven. A little smirk on his face from JCVD.
Tell him I'm a mouse hiding from the hawks in the house of the raven.
It's alive.
Chief Siluk tells him that that's just what a bear would say.
Yeah, and he's like, well, there's no fucking winning this then, is there?
Yeah. Then he rolls Taft over onto his stomach and throws some grit into his wounds.
Yeah, pulls out his trousers and then pulls some crystals out of his anus.
Yeah, and throws it into his wounds and starts digging around in there with his dagger.
Yeah, and he goes like this, ooh.
Yeah.
Ooh, that's tight.
Ooh, that's smart.
Yep, and she says, he says you sound like a bear as well. And he goes, like that.
Yeah. Otto and Johnny C, they can't find Taft's body because they're flying around in the helicopter above substation 101.
That's not where he is because he's obviously on the floor.
In Ice Station Zebra, wherever the fuck they are. Jennings tells them to keep bloody looking, hangs up, and then tells Lyles, we're heading to Aegis 1.
Yeah. He says, if you haven't found the body, he's alive.
Yeah.
A little hint there. It takes ages for us to get how badass he is, but we get there eventually. There's these little clues keep dropping in, but we'll get there.
Back to Seagal, he's dressed as the Cowardly Lion from The Wizard of Oz now, for some reason, poking his head out the tent where he's sleeping with a load of old people.
Yeah, sneaks out, doesn't he? There's a lot of fucking people in that tent. I bet that stinks.
Yeah. What do you think it smells of? Halibut?
Probably.
Yeah.
That's probably what they're all eating. That's what that old puppet woman was eating.
Yeah.
Spitting halibut into his face. Rubbing it in his ass. Rubbing it in his ass crack. Yeah. He'd get paid $350,000 for that, would he?
He's creeping out as all the Inuits are sleeping, and he's immediately attacked by the sled dogs.
By all of the dogs. One of them bites his dick.
Yeah.
One of them bites his bloody balls.
Bites him right on the pecker.
Yeah, he's like, oh, me pecker. off screen.
You just bit me on the bell end.
Hey, mind his balls.
Lord have mercy.
Yeah, so anyway, everyone comes running, because that's the very, very least use of stealth I've seen for quite some time, to be honest, that.
Yeah, for a big 7-foot fucking monster.
Yeah, and then they say to him, it's time for you to make your journey. And an eagle cries. And then we hear a story. He tells him a story about how the raven made the bear to protect the land from man, because man feared bear. And he just nods. Seagal nods like he understands a fucking word of what he's saying. And the eagle cries again, just to signify that that's now the end of the story.
Gets touched by a feather.
Yeah,
and instantly knocks him out.
Yeah. You know how to beat him in a fight then, don't you? Old Big Mike, if he'd have brought a fucking feather to the slappy hands game, yeah, he'd have been victorious.
Yeah.
But yeah, and then he tells us that he's already died twice. He fought the bear and he survived the river. And it's like, what? And we get to see that as well. Now, is that...
I think it's just a scene from Forest Warrior, isn't it?
Well, it's like, is it real? Has that happened prior to them finding him? Or is this like a dream that he had? Or is it like, is this part of the journey that he's telling him? But we get to see it. He fights a fucking bear.
Yeah, I think it's the dream, isn't it?
Yeah, but why is he telling him that that's what he's done? Is he planting that dream in his head?
Because he's an old fuck.
He's mental.
Yeah. It's insane, isn't he?
Rubbing halibut in his ass crack. He's not fucking fully there.
They're all chewing food and spitting in each
other's
mouths.
Pretends he's a bird.
Yeah.
In his spare time.
Exactly. The first time we saw him, he thought he was a raven. So, you know. Yeah, like when he falls in the water. That was funny.
Yeah.
That is a forest warrior.
That's a forest warrior. Yeah, but he does. He fights a bear. That's an actual real bear that Seagal is embracing in that scene.
I said this of Chuck Norris style from Forest Warrior. The working title for this film was Spirit Warrior.
Fucking hell. There you go. That'd have been good, though, wouldn't it?
He then goes, sort of manifests into a cave.
Yeah, where this is his dream, isn't it, after being KO'd by a feather.
Yeah, where he there's an old woman playing with a stick, and then there's a beautiful naked...
Eskimo tits is what I've written. Similar to what you were saying, I guess.
Oh, well, yeah, exactly. And then Seagal.
She's totally naked as well. Isn't she?
Yes.
Isn't she, Dom?
She is, yes.
Yeah, you get a full frontal. Yeah.
Oh, sorry about that. I didn't realise the desk was that long.
Yeah, you do. Eskimo frontal. If you ever wondered what an Eskimo's looks like, watch this. You get to see it. Quite well trimmed, to be honest, considering they live out there in the middle of nowhere. Better who's doing that for her. Still, then we get the old woman. Which one does he go to? He has a good old think, doesn't he? Which one does he go to?
He starts praying.
The beautiful, attractive, naked lady, which is obviously yes, please.
Which one would you go to?
Her. Fucking dicking around with some old woman with a rattle. Fuck that shit. I'm going to go and have some Eskimo sex. Oh, yeah. In flagrante. Be melting that bloody igloo straight away, straight through the ice.
What does that mean?
I don't know.
Excellent. So he chooses the old woman.
Oh,
and he has sex with her instead. Graphic 10-minute sex scene we've got to watch now.
Right up close as well. I've got a GoPro on his fucking bell end. Right into the old lady.
Yeah, one of Ken's films.
Yep. Anyway, he says, why are you upset? What the fuck's going on? And she says, I'm pained because the earth is dying.
Yeah.
And he's like, Lord have mercy.
Mother Nature is being hurt by the oil rigs. Mm. And then she shows him some water that's transforming into oil. And he wakes up and he's like, right, I'm fucking taking these bastards down after that dream.
That's enough of that.
What about if he'd have I think it was in the in Vern's book where he says, what about if he'd have chosen the old woman and that was the wrong choice? He should have gone with the young girl.
Yeah, because it was too obvious. Yeah, I think he does, doesn't he? Yeah, it's too obvious that the old woman's the right choice. Go to the young woman and have some fucking steamy sex.
Yeah.
That'd have been better, wouldn't it?
Yeah, it would have, yeah.
I'd have liked to have seen, that's probably one of the deleted scenes, isn't it, where he does go and have sex with her. And that really is a 10-minute scene. But then even, I've changed my mind. Thanks, though, love.
So Magruder and his team, they land their helicopter at the camp. They think Taft's there, but they can't find him.
They say, no, he isn't. They've never heard of him.
Yeah.
And they search the village. And what is it that gives him away, Dom? They find his fucking coat.
Yeah, yeah.
Then they say, no other man on earth would be wearing this fucking coat. And we don't even know how you got it. Because he was wearing his overalls when we blew him up. So where the fuck have you got his coat from?
Yeah. And also, exactly.
And they were like, I don't fucking know.
This is definitely his because there's some halibut in there. There's some hair bubbles.
Yeah, that's him, all right.
There's just a piece of paper that says,
I'm, if found, please return to Forest Taft.
Yeah. They still refuse to say that he was there. There's a scuffle that breaks out. And John C. McGinley shoots an old Inuit.
He shoots the bloody chief, doesn't he? Yeah. Old Chief Raven Dick.
Yeah.
shoots him dead. Well, shoots him to be dead.
Shoots him to be dead, exactly.
Yeah. That's how you shoot people.
And then they fuck off.
They get, in their chopper and fuck off again. Yeah. Like, whoops. Like,
everyone saw that. They provoked me, blah, blah, blah. Seagal comes back. Siluk's dying.
He's got a bloody sled, didn't he?
He is, yeah.
Has he been?
He's been off at the river having dreams of sex.
Sex with old ladies.
Yeah, exactly.
Rubbing halibut on his dick.
Well, it's pretty much the same thing.
old ladies out there, is it? Let us know. Let Dom know. He seems to think it is.
Sorry, old ladies. I know we've got a big fan base in the...
in the pension front. More tits than teeth.
It's alive!
Yeah, so they take Siluk into the hut and he's fucking dying. And he says, Steven Seagal, I've only just met you, but I love you. And Steven Seagal says, I love you too. He says it later on, which I thought, that's fucking weird. Like, why'd you love him? You only met him for 3 hours. After that, you were dressed as a lion.
Yeah, he's fucking spiritual. Loves him on a spiritual level.
Right. And he tells Taft that Taft is the warrior that will save them all. Mm-hmm. That he has a bear for a spirit guide. Taft says, tell your dad. Thank you.
I wrote that. I put big paws. Yeah. That's because he's a bear, isn't it?
Yeah, that's true.
They've all got big paws.
I was going to say something profound here, but he just says...
Yeah, just to tell him thank you.
Yeah.
Yeah, but a really big gap in the middle there. He gives him an amulet, doesn't he? A sacred amulet.
Yeah.
You know, that comes in useful later on. No, it doesn't. We don't fucking see it again.
Yeah.
Still.
And then he laughs.
Yeah, it's what he has. He's like, finally got rid of that fucking amulet.
Yeah. And then dies. And then I think it's supposed to signify that his spirit ascends into a raven and the raven flies off.
Yes.
Yeah.
I think the raven in Inuit lore is God, isn't it?
Taft and Mezu, they leave.
And off they go, and they're off to Hugh's house.
It's been trashed, the house has. They find it instantly, though, is the stuff they were looking for.
Yeah, because although it's been trashed, what they haven't done is looked in the closet. Or found a suspicious bag that's in the closet that actually contains the exact thing they were looking for.
It's a floppy disk. They take that, and as they...
He finds it in his cowboy boot.
Yeah.
Doesn't he?
And before they can leave, Magruder's men, they're there, including Otto, and they're attacked.
Yeah, he gives, what's her name?
Mezu,
yeah, he gives her some clothes.
Yeah, where's he got them from?
Fucking Hugh's got a bloody wardrobe full of ladies' clothes.
Yeah.
Dirty old Hugh.
Yeah.
Yeah, but he's also got clothes for Seagal to put on, which is, again, a bit weird, but he has. He's got clothes for everyone.
He did say earlier on that I've got a stash at your house.
Yeah, but he didn't say a fucking big change of clothes as well.
Well, I mean, he's got a waistcoat. He loves a waistcoat, Steve.
He
does,
yeah. He said a bag with weapons in it, which is the bag he's just found.
He said didn't something
say,
else, though,
he didn't say, I've got a whole fucking wardrobe dedicated to me at your house.
You know, because of the times that he gets drunk and gets himself over there. And
I don't know. It seems a bit odd, but still. Clothes for both of them, which is nice. Yeah, and then they're interrupted, looking at themselves in the mirror, by the bad guys.
Yeah, he's left a day pack, he says, at the beginning.
A day pack.
So his day pack is leather jacket.
The leather jacket, jeans.
Waistcoat.
Bullshit. I don't even know why he puts them on, because he takes it all off again and puts his bloody big old frill jacket back on later.
Of course he does. He's not going to not wear that jacket, is he?
Anyway, the bad guys turn up. He does some more hand movement gestures, which, as an Inuit, she would know, wouldn't she, from the fucking CIA, whatever it is he's pretending to be.
Yeah.
She understands those fully. I always like it when he does those.
Why has he even taken her with him?
I don't know.
What does she do?
She doesn't fucking do anything,
to
be honest.
She just stands next to him.
She's just there every time he does something. He goes back and there she is waiting where he left her.
Yeah.
But anyway, yeah, he does some hand movements, which means I'm going to shoot everyone who's just walked in. And she does just stand there totally still while he does that. Yeah, it's quite good though. It's even reminding me of Hard to Kill, where in the house.
Oh, because she looks at his dick.
Well, yeah. So, and I did as well, actually.
Yeah.
But no, it just reminded me of that, where he just shoots everybody that comes in
when
through
they
the
stay
windows.
At the doctor's house.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You just reminded me of that bit.
Sven Ole Thorsen gets the honour of a one-on-one fight with Steven Seagal.
Yep.
It gets no offense.
Doesn't last long at all, does it?
Gets no offense in whatsoever and gets bludgeoned to death with the whale bone.
Yep. Ironic, of course.
Yeah.
That's what he used.
And that's it. See you, Sven. Nice to see you again.
Yeah. Didn't get many lines. I think he did speak at one point, but that was it. And then he's beaten to death. He gets some glass smashing as well, though, isn't there?
Yeah.
Yeah, we get a couple of people being smashed through glass again, which is always nice.
Doesn't he, like, shoot upwards and shoot someone's fucking, like,
dick off? Because what he's doing is that's his hand movements. His hand movements are one upstairs, two that way. I'm going to go and kill them. And she's just like, okay.
What?
Go on, then. Yeah, he's like that. Yeah, I know. So, yeah, he does that, and then he just fires upwards through the floor. Because it's wooden floor, isn't it? A fucking Alaskan cabin.
Yeah.
Yeah, and that was his hand movement gestures thing.
We're just over halfway into the film, and this is where we get our first how badass is Steven Seagal
58
question.
58 minutes, this is. It's the 57 point whatever minute, so yes, and this is just who is this guy?
That's Johnny C saying that.
Yeah.
John C. McGinley hates his man so much he personally has to kill him, but he doesn't know anything about him now. And he says, who is this man? And Michael Caine says,
I mean, who the hell is this guy? Just who the fuck is he?
Who is he? You want to know who he is?
Sir.
Try this. Delve down into the deepest bowels of your soul. Try to imagine the ultimate fucking nightmare. And that won't come close to this son of a bitch when he gets pissed.
And John C. McGinley made me laugh, says, well, sir, I think we've got that one covered because he seems pretty pissed. What do you think to that for how badass is this
that's
man?
It's pretty good, isn't
it's
it?
It's fucking ridiculous.
I do like it. Yeah, but that's Michael Caine saying all that as well.
Yeah.
Imagine Michael Caine saying that about you.
Yeah.
You'd be like, fucking brilliant, that
is. It's like, oh, Dom's really scared that 90-year-old man over there.
He's not been 90 for fucking 30 years, has he?
I think he has.
Has he? Oh, okay. Fair enough. Sorry.
Magruder, he brings up taking on outside help in the form of mercenaries to help with Taft. Any ideas who that could be?
I haven't got a clue. No idea at all.
It's a mercenary group led by Stone, who's played by Arlie Ermey.
There he is.
Yeah.
I want to be your drill instructor.
How do you want him delivered? He asks Michael Caine, and he gives a great side look. No response, just gives him a look.
And he just says, understood.
Yeah. Taft goes to meet a man on a horse who looks a little sort of like a cross between Dom Lawton and Ken B. Wilde. He's got that sort of look about him. He's a bit of a Dom-Ken hybrid.
Yeah, is he a Native American as well?
I don't think so.
I don't know. I thought he might have been.
He might, possibly.
He looks a little bit like...
He's on a horse and he's got long hair, so he could be.
He looks a bit like the guy with the voice box in South Park.
He does.
He's a bit like him.
He looks a bit like the New England clam chowder guy from Ace Ventura. They let him into his
room.
So
there we go. I think that's a little insight there as to what we would look like if we were combined.
Yes. Hey, brudder. Is how they say hello to each other.
Of course it is.
All that was missing there was some sort of handshake or hug or something.
Yeah.
Yeah. Taft has a look through the floppy disk, and it's pressure readings from Aegis 1 that's on there. The whole goddamn platform is a time bomb.
Oh, Jesus.
As soon as it's turned on, it won't hold the pressure. And they're looking at the high chemical levels, and it looks to Taft like Jennings is going to pump the land of all its oil, and then he's going to inject the chemicals back into the land. The deadly chemicals.
Fucking hell.
And then sell it onto a competitor.
Fucking hell.
Is that about the size of it?
I think so.
Yeah.
Yeah. It all got a bit complicated as to, really, is that even something you can fucking do?
Yeah.
But whatever.
And it's like Taft always says, Ken.
Yep.
We've got to blow it. And we've got to blow it now.
Yeah. He said that to me once.
He did. Yep. Well, that was one of your films, of course.
Yeah, and I did. Yeah. 350 grand it cost him.
Nice.
Yeah, but I did.
Meizu wants us to let the authorities... Not us. He wants...
All right.
Meizu wants to let the authorities and the press handle it.
Yeah, she says, no, Forrest, no!
Not run, Forrest, run.
No. No.
But he dismisses her. He negates everything he learned from his spiritual journey.
He fucking does, doesn't he?
He calls it all mystical hocus pocus.
Yeah, it gives us a really cynical view about the cold, hard reality of having to use force to fucking sort this shit out.
Yeah, never mind pretending. I can't walk in there pretending I'm a bird.
Yeah, or a fucking bear walking around going grah at people. And they've got fucking machine guns and shoot me dead, you idiot.
Yeah, he's got the frill jacket on again.
Of course he has. I don't know where that was. Possibly at our house.
Yeah. And they're on horseback.
Yeah, why not?
Brilliant.
Off up the fucking mountain, aren't they?
In the helicopter, we've got Stone, we've got Magruder. Stone's giving Magruder the rollicking of his life for not doing a background check on Taft before hiring him, saying that they don't know anything of his training, military career. They don't know jack shit about him.
He says they haven't got anything. They haven't got anything since like before he started working for them. Yeah, he's been a ghost.
It's some guy who we've never seen before just interjects and he says, I couldn't find anything on Taft before 1987. Which means, which is equally plausible, these two, that he was either born fully grown or his background is so top secret, it doesn't even flag top secret when you search it.
I'm going for the first one. I think Steven Seagal actually tells that story that he was born fully grown.
Yeah, that's
part of his one of his interviews. He said that,
and they're guessing that it must mean he's ex-CIA.
They throw a few acronyms in there. CIA, they got NSA. I think they also throw it and make one up.
DDS,
DOB, DDP, DDP.
Yeah,
they throw him in.
His famed wrestler Diamond Dallas Page for a while in the late 80s.
I'm actually dealing with exports in my job. And DDP is a payment that you can make.
Yeah.
Yeah, delivery due with payments. I can't remember what it fucking means, but yeah. And the lady who sits opposite, she does it all. And she says DDP a lot. And every time she does it, I move and look at her. And she knows that I'm thinking, it's me, it's me, it's DDP.
Who's saying you'd give her a diamond cutter out of nowhere?
She didn't know that until I mentioned it. And now I'd mention it all the time. So the legend lives on. I'll tell you what else she said once. She went into a meeting. She went into a meeting and she'd accused somebody of being like unprofessional and condescending and all that shit. And she went in
Oh, okay.
Yeah, I was like, oh yeah, all right, love. And she had a meeting to try and like mediate the whole thing. And she sat and she said what she wanted to say was, it's a whole different ballpark. But she also wanted to say it's a whole new bag. And what she really said was, it's a whole new ball bag in that mediation meeting. And then realised what she'd said. And the guy that she had accused of it didn't fucking even flinch. Didn't acknowledge it, nothing. And I think he's proved himself he's all right. Because if she'd have said ball bag to me, I would have laughed at her. Quite
it's got a whole new ball bag.
Yeah, this is just a whole new ball bag. People are like, yeah, but she didn't laugh. He didn't laugh. I think there may have been a meeting of the eyes and just carry on.
Meanwhile, in a shack on the side of a mountain, Meizu is verbally wanking Taft off over the amount of explosives he has in there.
It's literally his fucking floor to ceiling explosives.
Why,
it's all
why
he's
he got
in there. It's all he's got. He says, in case. She's like, in case of what? World War III. He's like, yeah.
Stone and Magruder, they decide that they need to get to the cabin on the horseback because they can't fly the helicopter there, even though they can in the second. Stone says to drop them off.
Where are they getting horses from? Halfway up a fucking mountain.
He's called someone. He's got a horse guy nearby.
A horse man. The man of many horses.
Yep.
Halfway up a fucking mountain in case somebody needs him for the first time ever.
And he tells them, drop us down here, we'll get on the horses, and then the helicopter can fly around, and when we smoke him out, he'll just kill them.
Well, he's got he has a look. We've got some C4, we've got some claymores, we've got a couple of mouse traps, we've got wire, we've got some pegs in case he's putting his washing out on the line as well. He puts his coat out there, give it a nice airing.
Yeah,
but yeah, so he's loading all that up. He switches something on as well, doesn't he, that lets them track him to where he is because he wants them to come, which is the whole point. That's how they know where he is. But they find him fucking immediately. Surely it's not supposed to be immediate, is it? I thought it was like to maybe get them when they've gone. But they're still fucking there when they find him.
Yeah.
Still, it all turns out okay because they blow a helicopter up.
Yeah, Taft hears a helicopter, I think. Starts rigging up a bomb. brief glimpse of the Seagal run as well.
Yep, only very brief, but he does it.
The shack explodes, and the explosion is so massive that Seagal, who's standing next to it's all right, but the helicopter is blown back into the side of the mountain.
It's because he's fucking set it, though.
Yeah.
So it doesn't explode on him.
Yeah, that's like in video games.
Yeah.
Where your own men can't hurt you.
You're okay, yeah.
Yeah. Mercs and Johnny C, they're on horses. They're chasing after Taft. Mazu's again, still with him for some reason. Taft, he's planting booby traps. They've got so far ahead that he can stop and do the Home Alone booby trap thing.
He does well as well, doesn't he? Some good stuff.
Yeah. They find one of his traps. They laugh it off, saying, I thought he was going to be good, and a Cub Scout could have found that. And then one of the guys says, you watch it, sweetheart. Talk like that will get you killed. Says Billy Bob Thornton.
Billy Bob bloody Thornton?
Randomly, just as some no-name merc.
Fucking hell, Billy Bob.
On horseback. Anyway, they walk on and immediately run into another trap, killing one of them in a nice little practical effect.
Yep, a big bold panic, isn't it? It's quite good bloodshed, actually, in that little bit.
Yeah, I like that bit. One guy gets the old...
Squibs. Squibs galore.
Yeah, it's with one of the Bond girls.
I'm Squibs galore. Well, of course you are.
Please call me Squibs. They walk
there's,
on.
There's a Twitter account called Daily Squibs, which I do look at. It is literally just scenes where people get shot and stuff like that.
Mm.
But it really is good because it just makes me miss all of those. The good old days of Squibs.
Squibs.
Remember, everyone. Remember the glory days of Squibs. Anyway.
Yes, and I like the one guy who falls off his horse, rolls down the hill, and fucking perishes on punji sticks.
Yeah, he fucking set sticks up.
Yeah.
How fucking far ahead was he?
He gets knocked off by, like, there's a branch that, like, flings out.
He falls quite a long way as well, so he set them up knowing full well the trajectory of the branch hit and how that would react. Fucking amazing.
He's already stopped rolling as well, but then the next cut is just this body on Squibs. It's really funny the way they've done that bit. Seagal is jumping over a cliff as well.
Did you just say Squibs again? Body on Squibs.
Oh, sorry, punji sticks.
He's gone Squib mad. Help, help. Dom's gone Squib mad.
Join us for Squib September. We get Seagal jumping over a cliff in slow motion on his horse.
It's fucking amazing, isn't it?
Oh, man. This is just every Seagal. This is the quintessential Seagal film. This encapsulates him.
Now, of course, the horse would have been physically exhausted as soon as Seagal even looked at it. But back in then, in his prime,
yeah,
beautiful.
He looks like Mongo from Blazing Saddles now, if he'd have done this scene.
Oxtail soup.
Yeah.
Yeah, but he does. He's very, very lovely, isn't it? Slow motion, jumping over. She follows, of course. Yeah, they both get over. And then they blow the ravine.
Yeah.
So they can't. It's too big now, isn't it, the gap? So they can't do it.
Yeah. This guy's good. At least we know where he's going. That's what Stone says.
Yeah, so over there.
Aegis won. That same night, Taft with Mazu still following for no reason whatsoever. They break into the Aegis rig.
He tells us the only way to get there is through the refinery. She's like, well, yeah, I can see that. He goes, okay. I was telling the listeners. Or the viewers, sorry.
Lots of just innocent people killed
this,
by Seagal.
This bit I really enjoyed. He snips a little hole in the fence, and we get to see multiple angles of him doing this for no fucking reason whatsoever. You know, like when Van Damme used to do his spinny jump kick?
Yeah.
And you get to see that from fucking loads of angles because it's impressive. This one, you get about four different angles of him cutting a fence. And I thought, why? But they're really quick cuts as well. So it's like, bing, 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 bing. And you think, okay,
but
action.
Every single time he cuts the fence, he's looking at the camera so with every different angle.
Yeah, but he follows the... He looks as it's on him.
Briefly, like, you see his, like, movement.
That would be great. Especially if he had a finger to his lips saying, shh. Yeah, but he does. It's a multiple angles fence snipping, which I really appreciated. He's the director. He fucking decided on that.
Yeah.
Why would you even have multiple cameras set up for that bit? But he did, and he used every one of them. Brilliant.
Yeah. FBI, they're in there. They get called in.
The fucking anti-terrorism set up from the FBI.
They get called in by Jennings, who says that Taft is going to be here. He needs to be treated as a terrorist threat. And the FBI says, don't worry, we're going to be all over this like white on rice. Unless, of course, two of our men get killed and we're all going to run. Just as the FBI do.
That's just the it. That's how we work.
Yeah.
Meanwhile, Forrest Taft is making a DIY silencer out of a drinks bottle.
Yeah, what the fuck's all this about? That wouldn't work, would it?
It does. Although he shoots through glass, which smashes and makes the noise of smashing glass. So I don't know what the point of that was.
Yeah.
But he does. He also literally throws a spanner in the works. Doesn't he? By placing a spanner in the works.
Yes.
It's like, he must have written that and then forgot what he meant and thought, oh, okay. When he went back to it and got a spanner and threw it in the works.
It's weird why I've written this, but, you know, we better go for it.
It could be okay. He kills three more people. He's just murdering people, isn't he? He's just killing people.
I said, this
we don't really know. We don't really know if these are bad guys either.
That's what I said. It looks like there's a lot of just innocent oil workers getting just killed here.
Because he does evacuate the workmen, doesn't he?
The one area, though.
But so he must assume that everybody in this area is evil. Yeah. But everyone do it down there. That's probably they're okay, those guys.
Yeah. Also, doesn't this look, Ken, like the chemical factory in Batman? Doesn't it, though?
It does a bit, yes.
Yeah, it does, doesn't it?
Yes, it does.
You're going to see Jack Nicholson dancing around to Love Shack.
Imagine Jack Nicholson being in it. Like Michael Caine, Jack Nicholson.
Ooh. Love Shack, baby.
Oh, yeah, Lawrence. He also gets called. You get another little bit of how badass is he. He says, Forrest Taft is the patron saint of the impossible.
I love that line.
That's a fucking great line.
That's a fucking great line. That's how I'd like to be described.
You're not, though.
Ken, I'm well aware. I'm just saying that's why I said I'd like to be described.
Oh, right. Okay.
Ken, did you know I am described? do you like Taft's darker frill jacket? Because he's undercover. He's incognito. Yeah. So he's gone for a darker trim.
Of course I do, yes.
Darker trim was one of your names, wasn't it?
Yes. I was going to say darker hue, but he's dead, unfortunately, yeah. Along with his brother. Normal here.
I bet you're wondering why I'm called Dark Hickory.
They get lights out, lights all going out, and the lady, the secretary, she says, he's back, which I didn't really like.
I didn't like that either.
But I do like it when they immediately know who's causing the issue. That's how I want to be. You know, you said you wanted to be called the patron saint of the impenetrable, whatever it was.
That just makes it sound like no one wants to have sex with me,
mm-hmm.
Which is slightly too accurate for this podcast.
Okay,
too much truth
that.
Being told.
Sorry. I always liked it. I said about Raiders of the Lost Ark.
Why are you removing clothing throughout this episode?
It's none of your business.
Okay. Is there going to be a grand reveal of a new fucking Seagal tattoo?
I've got his coat tattooed.
Just on your
skin. With frills, yeah. I've had scarification.
All 3D.
Yeah, but I've got bits of skin hanging loosely from my arms.
Oh, that is fucking horrible.
Yeah, wait till you see it.
Yeah.
Made me sick. I'm stuck with it.
Not the first time Ken's had this conversation. Yeah, go on.
Fuck it. Wait.
He sets the preventers to implode. He sets up C4. He's staging all this.
Why has he got
now.
To do that? They're already going to implode.
That's true.
Why is he trying to stop the place from exploding by blowing it up? What the fuck is this plan?
That's
it was
true.
Already going to explode. All he's doing is doing it earlier.
Yeah, I didn't
by
think of
sabotage.
That.
It was already going to go.
Yeah.
All he really had to do was sneak in and evacuate all the workers.
Yeah.
And then let it blow up anyway.
Yeah.
But
he's already got the evidence.
Yeah, but what he's going to do instead is destroy everything anyway and then blame Jennings.
Yeah, because he's got the evidence from Hugh, so why the fuck does he need to do any of this?
It's a very unusual idea.
I like it when stuff starts blowing up and John C. McGinley's just like, Taft, you son of a bitch! I like that. Jennings is in the control center. He's speaking to one of the boffins who says that he's blown up three of the generators.
Something like that.
But Jennings says the only way he can shut us down is if he gets to the rig. and that's swarming with FBI. And he says he'd need a miracle to stop us now.
And then it goes, Flash!
He's a miracle.
He's a motherfucking spirit bear.
We've got just enough time left for Stone to give us one of the best How Tough Is Seagal monologues.
Another fucking badass, isn't it? Yes. This is like, what the hell are you talking about?
And I've written it down.
Please, please do, because it's one of those where you, if you just, no, it's nonsense, but it's beautiful nonsense.
Intel tells us we're dealing with one guy. We think we got a fucking fire team out there.
My guy in D.C. tells me that we are not dealing with a student here. We're dealing with a professor. Anytime the military has an operation that can't fail, they call this guy in to train the troops, okay? He's the kind of guy that would drink a gallon of gasoline so he could piss in your campfire. You could drop this guy off at the Arctic Circle wearing a pair of bikini underwear without his toothbrush, and tomorrow afternoon he's going to show up at your poolside with a $1 million smile and a fistful of pesos. This guy's a professional, you got me? If he reaches this rig, we're all going to be nothing but a big goddamn hole right in the middle of Alaska. So let's go find him and kill him and get rid of this son of a bitch.
That's one of the better monologues as well, isn't it? You got it two is. Beautiful ones
It
there.
Is, but what on earth is he talking about? And why is it like 10 minutes before the end of the film?
Yeah, like we already know.
Yeah, it's just like we've seen him do all this other stuff. We know all that.
And when did he stop to take that call? And how's he memorized it?
And why on earth is he waxing so lyrical about the whole thing when time is of the essence as everything around them is exploding?
I just like the fact that, guy from DC, what have you got for me? This man is the type of
man. Let me tell you something. Yeah. Picture the scene.
Not just his credentials. He's fucking telling about pools and bikini bottoms and fucking hell. We get more darkly lit shooting, running. There's a death of FBI agents. And then because they kill a couple of them, they all just run off.
Yeah.
They also do release noxious gas.
I suppose, yeah. That's not going to help matters, is it?
No.
Johnny C. McGee, he's out of there. Yep. He's fucking legging it. He's had enough of this shit.
It's like, you'd be mental to stay here. I'm leaving. Lyle, she gets up and...
Yep, she pretends she's just going for a shit.
Yeah, that's what she says.
Yeah, where are you going? I'm just going for a shit.
Yep.
Michael Caine.
But yeah, they fuck off anyway. And as they do that, they're trying to get into the helicopter. Taft turns up, shoots the back propeller so that they can't lift off.
Yep, so they get out.
Lyle says, fuck this, I'm getting out of here.
Runs I'm going off. For that shit.
Yep. I'm going for the... What's she getting? It's like a truck.
A truck, yeah. She gets in a little ute.
Magruder, he tries to bargain his way out.
He thinks the thing I can do here is I can just talk my way out of this after having killed his friends and the chief.
The big chief.
Big chief Raven fuck.
If you want to finger Michael Caine, you're going to have to let me live because I've got all the evidence on him.
Yeah, I can help you finger him.
Yeah.
I've got everything you need to finger him good.
Unless you can help me finger him right now, you're no good to me.
Mm.
And he's like, yes, I can. Right in my pocket. And he tries to pistol whip him and does not succeed.
You don't ever succeed. No one succeeds in that.
No.
Bloody Forrest Taft.
Steven Seagal picks him up. John C. McGinley, massive, picks him up and throws him into the propellers.
Yeah.
We don't see it, but I would have loved to.
Yeah, we just get the blood splatter, don't we?
Yeah. That would have been a great practical effect. Just throw like
You're not going to fucking show that. You bloody madman.
But yeah, that's it. So John C. McGinley dead. Very upsetting for me. I'm a big, big John C. McGinley fan.
Yeah.
Anyway, Lyle, in the most stupid, pointless, unnecessary death in a film, is driving past him, and she's just like, so long, or you'll never catch me.
So long, suckers.
Isn't looking, turns, and classic action movie, instead of preventing her death, puts her hands up to her face.
Yep, because she's about to hit something.
And she hits like a petrol tanker.
Of course she does. It's a fucking oil refinery. They're all over the bloody place.
She is the roof off the car. She's sitting there with blood all over her head. Petrol leaks out. There's some naked flame nearby, of course.
Why not?
Because it's an oil refinery. You'd have that. And
it's because of the explosions, Dom. It's not just always there.
I think
in the middle of
a
fucking action scene.
And she just fucking blows up.
Yep, sparks the flame, follows all the way to the vehicle. She goes,
that is the most unnecessary death.
She fucking deserved it, Dom. All of them have deserved deaths. Anyway, that's enough of that. And then we cut up to level 6. And who have we got up on level 6 having a little chat? It's fucking Billy Bob Thornton. He's up there now, level 6, discussing how does he look cool.
Yeah, about what he's talking about
fucking,
his...
What the hell is that all about?
I don't know.
It's like Seagal's made his own fucking script up. Now Billy Bob Thornton's making his own script up in a Seagal film.
Yeah.
Anyway, it didn't last long.
Stone, he says to one of his men, I want you to protect this rig like it's your sister's cherry, Tonto.
Mm-hmm. He's a Native American. Person he's speaking to.
Is that a racial slur that he's saying to him, or is that his actual name?
We don't know either way, to be honest. I've not checked the cast. Maybe in the cast he is called Tonto, but I don't know, without checking. He says it twice in the same scene, so maybe it is his name, or maybe he's just very, very racist.
Yeah, there's like 3 or 4 idiots sitting around tasting gasoline dropping down onto them. Like, oh, what's this? Is this gasoline? And as they finish that thought, Seagal's next to them and just blows
kills,
them.
He just kills them instantly.
It's like the stupidest way of dying. Billy Bob Thornton, he turns...
What did they think it was to be tasting it? What is this, beer?
Yeah.
Is somebody dripping beer on us?
Yeah, I think it must be in this oil refinery. Billy Bob Thornton blows himself up by shooting a claymore.
Yeah, idiot.
Taft, Stone just gets fucking blown apart.
He's hiding, isn't he? Like the fucking Colonel Kurtz.
He's hiding some oil or some shit.
Yeah. And he comes out and he's like, ha ha, now I've got you. And holds him at shotgun point. Seagal, obviously, you don't do that to Seagal. Especially you don't let him get as close as you do let him here. And he gets so close that all he does... He flips the old shotgun around and just blasts him to death instantly.
Yep.
And that's the end.
Yep.
He's gone.
Stone done.
He's gone. Army Ermy. He's out of there. Off to instruct drills in the sky.
Nice fight with a metal pole, I've put.
He does do well, actually. I like this one. Yeah. Jennings is on his own now. He's just there trying to sort shit out because everyone else has fucked off or been blown up or shot or whatever. So he's trying to sort stuff out.
It's my favourite death scene right now.
He gives us he's got a timer, which he sets for 9:50. And then he says, right, we got to get out of here. We've got less than 3 minutes before it blows. I was like, what? What? How? Why? You've just, oh, whatever. Yeah.
Well,
he's
watched Forest Warrior, hasn't he? You can't set it too early. You've got to give yourself enough time.
I suppose so. And then we get, it's another great fight, isn't it?
Then my favourite death scene in this film is brutal as fuck. Which is like, considering you don't see anything of any other death scene, this is quite brutal. Is the guy who runs around the corner with the knife.
The knife guy, yeah.
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 And Seagal just forces the knife into this guy's own face.
Yeah, he just flips his arm back up, doesn't he? Yeah. And stabs himself in the face and then...
Yeah, turns him round and just forces his face into the wall.
Slams him into the wall.
That is such a good death scene.
Yeah, it is.
How quick he does it.
It is really
as well.
Quick as well, yeah. Yeah. No, it's good because even the shotgun disarmament is very, very fast and looks reasonably effective.
Yeah.
Looks like that could have worked.
But in that initial bar scene as well, it's quite funny watching him run quickly and throw people into the jukebox. But he is, for his size, he's fucking quick.
Back then he was.
Yeah.
Yeah, he could do stuff back then. So you actually do believe that he's doing it. You watch videos of him since, so he's just like fucking choreographed worse than these films.
And it's crazy to see him, how he disarms people and like how quick he is to do that sort of stuff.
Yeah, but that's a very good fight. And he does use his metal pole, doesn't he?
He's really good with that. Yeah.
So he's doing a bit of spinning with that, hits people in the face with that. A little bit easy, perhaps, some of them. But locks this guy's arm up as well with the metal pole, sort of locks him, disarms him, locks his arm, smashes him through some glass, which somebody did that to me once, actually. They were doing Aikido, and they were learning with weapons. And we had a broom handle at work, and he said, go to attack me. And he did it, and he pushed the broom handle underneath my arm, over my elbow, and flipped it. And yeah, you ain't getting out of that. You go down onto the ground, otherwise you'll snap your fucking arm out.
Yeah.
Which is really good. Obviously, I loved it. I thought, that's brilliant. Please break my other arm.
Thank you so much. Yeah.
Yeah, but it is very effective. There's no way you can go. Either you break it or you're fucking on the floor. So it's good stuff, and it happens very, very quickly. I love his fucking fighting style when he was in this 90s period.
Yeah.
Really, really good fun. and incredibly fucking painful looking.
That was the thing as well. Like, these looked like they were actually fucking... You know, Seagal, Van Damme with his, like, big kicks and his big legs.
His
and,
big legs.
You know, this is different. This was more gritty, wasn't it?
Yeah, this, yeah. This just looked like it was fucking ow.
Yeah,
every
like
single time.
Out for justice.
Yeah, that Nico. Was nasty. Nasty yeah. stuff, yeah, yeah. But brilliant. Loved it.
He confronts Jennings anyway. He's trying to keep the rig running. He's
this is where he calls him Michael. So this is like fucking 3 minutes before the end. He suddenly calls him Michael. And that's why I thought it was a mistake.
Yeah, he asks Taft if this whore is why he's doing all this. Points to it. Because remember, she's still there.
Yeah.
Maisu's
yeah,
still there.
She's done fuck all, but she yeah. is still there.
Saying that they bought hookers better than this for $5 in Bangkok. Which is why I was saying I'd like to have seen the prequel.
That would have been good, wouldn't it?
Yeah.
Michael Caine and Steven Seagal in Bangkok.
Yeah, just fucking
looking
whores.
For hookers.
yeah.
Yeah. It's actually hopefully a documentary on the Blu-ray
yeah.
where they go out there just to source material.
He has a go at Jennings anyway, he says, what does one say to a man with no conscience?
Yeah, he said, I've been thinking about this for some time. That's what he's been thinking about. Through all of the bloodshed and explosions, he's been thinking about, I really hope I get to ask that question.
Yeah. And he says, I'd like to tell you about the millions of people that you made suffer, but I'd be a total idiot to think that you'd care.
He also says, you really are a piece of shit, Michael.
Yeah.
And I thought, whoa, that really is his name.
Yeah.
That's offensive.
Scum of the earth, he calls him as well.
Yeah, but he called him Michael. Because first of all, the first time he calls him that, he says, oh, well, if it's my old friend Michael, which is when I thought, he's fucked that up, hasn't he? He's got that wrong.
Yeah.
He's accidentally called him Michael. But then he also says, you really are a piece of shit, Michael. And that's the only two times his first name is ever mentioned in the film, which is why I think it was an error still.
Jennings says that he's leaving, saying that Taft is a macho man with a code of honour. You won't shoot me in the back.
He doesn't. He gets a bit of wire and he lassoes his leg.
Lassoes him, because you know what Michael Caine, the big old Texan that he is in this film, lassoes him, ties him up. And hangs him upside down over the oil tanker, a bit like Jack Nicholson in the Batman film. You know when he falls into the big
oh, yeah,
rat?
Love Shack.
Love Shack, yeah. Baby.
That's what Michael Caine shouts. Love Shack, baby.
Love Shack, baby.
Oh no, Lawrence. Yeah. Let's broaden our minds. That's what he says as he's hanging upside down.
He taunts him, Jennings. He tells him to shoot him. Says you haven't got the fucking minerals.
You ain't got the cojones.
Yeah.
I like the fact we've got all the way through this without doing any Michael Caine impressions.
We haven't really, yeah.
We're throwing them all in.
We did more impressions of Michael Caine in Labyrinth than we have in this. Yeah, he says that Taff hasn't got the guts to shoot him, and Taff says that he wouldn't dirty his bullets.
Mm. Not that he's going to retrieve them and use them again, though, is it?
No.
But still.
And then instead, he shoots the cord that's holding him up.
Yeah, because she says something. She says something about Forrest or Taft. She says something, and he just fucking shoots the cord.
And drops Jennings into the oil, big vat of oil, and he...
Which is, I don't know if you noticed draft. This, but I found that very similar to the 1989 Batman.
Really?
That's where he falls into the big vat.
Yeah?
Yeah, I did, yeah, I thought that.
I like, after he's fallen into the vat and is dead, Meizu says... This is for my father.
Yeah.
It's a bit fucking late now.
He's not heard that.
No.
He's not heard that. He's potentially dead, though we don't know. And he previously said, if you haven't found his body, he's alive.
Yeah.
But we'll ignore all that.
When he falls, his legs are not tied. Like,
no.
He's falling.
He could so, just. He
could you
just
not just get out of oil?
I'd imagine you could. Yeah.
Yeah, because it's not like.
It's not like a tar pit from the fucking prehistoric times,
yeah,
is it?
Yeah, yeah, exactly. Taft and Mazu, they escape. The rig explodes. Everything explodes.
Everything fucking explodes. My bloody beer exploded as I was watching it. My TV blew up. I fucking my left leg exploded. I ain't got that anymore.
My dick exploded.
My dick exploded watching the earlier scene of the naked Eskimo lady. Everything exploded. My fucking house blew up. I don't know where I'm supposed to live now. Thanks a lot, Forrest. It's fucking mental. Still. Then we cut to the Alaska state capital with what I would suggest is possibly the least inspirational ending of an action film I've ever fucking seen.
Is this Neil Breen levels of
this
final...
This is unbelievable. Yeah, the president of the bank, he resigned. It was honestly, it was incredible, this. This is a good 4 fucking minutes of speech as well. Amazing stuff.
I've got a fun fact for you about this.
Oh, please.
Producer and director Steven Seagal filmed almost 40 minutes of footage for the environmental message at the end of the movie and planned to use it all in the final.
Fucking hell.
After pressure from Warner Brothers and a disastrous preview screening where audience members booed, laughed and made obscene gestures for the entire sequence, Seagal cut the final scene down to 7 minutes.
7 minutes? Oh, yeah. Fuck, I was generous then with 4.
Yeah.
Fucking hell.
And also, the one I was going to...
zoned out for 3 of them.
I had another fun fact that I was supposed to bring up earlier, but I'll bring it up now. Sven Ole Thorsen, when he met Seagal on set, Seagal asked Thorsen to kick him to show what Thorsen was capable of. And Thorsen, because it's Seagal, didn't like put full force into it, just hesitantly kicked him. Seagal caught his leg and threw him to the ground. So Seagal asked Thorsen to kick him again, give it his best shot. Thorsen kicked Seagal as fast and hard as he could, and Seagal fell to the ground. And when shooting a scene together a day or two later, Seagal hit Thorsen in the throat, leaving Thorsen unconscious for 3 or 4 seconds. And it looks so realistic that Seagal decided that Thorsen's character had died and left that scene in the film. So that wasn't how he's originally supposed to have died, but he thought it looked so devastating that that's how he left it in the scene.
Oh, that's nice of him. What a nice guy.
There's nothing but nice...
I hear a lot of nice stories about working with Steven Seagal,
yeah. Would you like it if this was 40 extra minutes?
Anyway, this speech, right? he's given a speech to the council, says that they've asked him to, which I don't know if that's fucking true. They don't look at that interested, so they perhaps haven't. But he gives us all of this bullshit about big business.
Yeah.
It's one of our favourites, isn't it? Big business. He mentions big business.
Mr. Big Business.
Yeah, mentions that a lot. Talks about how we're destroying the earth and we're all bastards. In like peppered throughout, we get imagery of what he's talking about, oil spills and animals being hurt. And
the Michael Jackson Earth song that we won't fucking play.
We're not allowed, otherwise we'll get like YouTube will stop us from being available. I'm not sure where, Canada, I think it was.
I blame Canada for that.
Well, South Park blamed Canada for quite a few things.
Exactly.
But yeah, it's very, very moving, very powerful, and incredibly fucking long. Yeah, so we get all that. We basically, Steven Seagal saves the world from itself.
Here's a clip of that fucking diatribe that he goes into anyway.
Yep, see you in 40 minutes.
The most common and God-given rights have been taken away from us. Unfortunately, the reality of our lives is so grim, nobody wants to hear it. Now I've been asked what we can do. I think we need a responsible body of people that can actually represent us rather than big business. This body of people must not allow the introduction of anything into our environment that is not absolutely biodegradable or able to be chemically neutralized upon production. And finally, as long as there's profit to be made from the polluting of our earth, companies and individuals will continue to do what they want. We have to force these companies to operate safely and responsibly, with all our best interest in mind, so that when they don't, we can take back our resources and our hearts and our minds and do what's right.
He's then blessed by a medicine man who says a load of shit, but ends up with the line, "The earth is our grandmother."
Mm-hmm.
And we hit the credits.
We do. And that's it. He saves the world. The world is saved due to Steven Seagal.
Do you like the mid-credit scene?
Very, very, very interesting.
It's Taft and Mezu. They're on a canoe in the middle of the lake. I'm
assuming. In the
middle
of fucking nowhere, aren't they?
I'm assuming he's about to have sex with her.
I believe so. Not in a canoe. That's got to be dangerous, hasn't it? In a canoe.
He's on deadly ground, Ken. That's what he means. That's what
we
this whole...
what happened in Bloody Forest Warrior in a canoe.
Yeah,
that's sheriff. True. The sheriff just walked past his own wife.
Yeah.
And they capsized the fucking thing. They weren't even up to hanky-panky.
Well, Mezu smiles at Taft, and Taft looks up, sees the spirit of Siloc flying overhead.
Well, he sees a raven.
In the form of a raven.
Yeah, he just sees a raven, Dom.
That's Siloc. He's looking over
is
them.
It? Yeah, right. Yeah, okay.
That's the end, and I'd like to just finish, as I usually do, with a little Vern quote, which I think perfectly encapsulates, Ken, if you'd let me.
Mm-hmm.
He talks basically about, like, in Japan, the emotional truth of things is more important than the actual truth. This is how one of Seagal's friends...
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
explains away why Seagal says all these lies about himself. Is about because Seagal talks about the emotional truth rather than the actual truth.
Oh, bloody hell, that's confusing.
So Vern says, "Whilst On Deadly Ground is far from a literal depiction of the real world, it does contain that emotional truth that is more important. And I think the fact that Seagal puts this message in the context of a lowbrow form like an action movie, as opposed to a respectable mainstream drama, where an ecological message would seem more natural, makes it more subversive and certainly more entertaining. Maybe it's not as successful as John Carpenter's They Live, but it's coming from the same place." He says, "The earlier Seagal films of the Golden Era are my favourites, but it is On Deadly Ground and the films that follow in its wake that make Seagal such a fascinating figure. Before this movie, he was a popular action star, like so many others. Only now did he become Steven fucking Seagal."
Oh.
It's alive! It's alive! It's alive!
So is this going into the bad movie cult?
It's a difficult one, really, because I thought it was a good film. But at the same time, it's a bit fucking ridiculous, isn't it? So, I don't know. I'd quite like to not put it in. What about you? Would you put this in?
I think for the slappy hand scene and the what does it take to change the essence of a man and the whole thing about rituals and the jacket, I think it's got to go in.
Really? You think the nonsense outweighs the good?
Yes. Because
there's an awful lot of nonsense, I'll give it that.
I think
so. Okay. But it can go in.
I think, Ken, we're going to have to throw it over to our third judge, Michael Caine. Let me just ring him up.
That's a good phone ring he's got, isn't it? Hello?
Oh, sorry, I think I've got the wrong number. Is this Michael Caine's residence?
No.
I didn't think so, sorry.
Oh, well, I guess we won't be doing that then.
Well, that's a shame. We're going to have to decide amongst ourselves.
Well, that was a good effort.
Yeah.
But unfortunately, we got the wrong number there.
No.
So,
it happens sometimes in live media.
Well, okay then. So, so you say yes, and I'm not sure. It could go in 150%.
Excellent.
Because I'm not sure. So we can't do that, can we? Can't be 150% if I'm not sure. So it'd be 75%. So the majority goes in.
Yeah. So there we go. Fire down below. Maybe we'll do you next, because this is not that film. It's On Deadly Ground. You have been inducted into the bad movie cult.
Barely,
by
Stephen.
The skin of your teeth. Michael Caine, welcome. You've been inducted. John C. McGinley.
Fucking hell.
Second time inducted, or did we not induct Point Break?
I don't know if we did.
I don't think we did.
I'm pretty sure we didn't.
That's kind of funny, isn't
that
it?
That would have fucking caused chaos if we'd inducted Point Break.
Yeah. So, Johnny C., second time, but first time induction.
He's on 50-50.
So, there we go. I think that's it. I don't think we're going to do a pitch, are we? Because we've had enough.
Yeah, we have, yeah. How have you enjoyed Eco Action August?
Not at all.
Not you, Dom. I was asking the listeners.
Right.
You fucking haven't.
From the viewing figures the other day.
Hey, whoa. That was Forest Warrior. Forest Warrior is it was a difficult film for us to cover, and literally only covered it because of the chainsaw stopping Chuck Norris scene. So, you know, thank you for listening if you have listened. Obviously, if our listening fan base has dropped off significantly since then, sorry. But, you know, please come back.
Whatever we said, whatever we did, we didn't mean it.
We just want you back for good.
We want you back.
For good.
So next time you hear from us, it's going to be a brand spanking new month.
Yes, it's a new month. It's a new theme. So we can put this eco nonsense to bed. We can stop throwing tins of paint at shit.
Yeah.
And, you know, we can stop all this nonsense of sitting in the road trying to stop people from getting to work and doing their normal fucking thing. You know, so we can stop doing that now. I've stopped it. Dom's still doing it a little bit. You know, he's sat in the road. That's where he's recording from today. But we're going to stop doing all that, and we're going to hit you with a brand new month. Are we telling them what it is, Dom?
Yes, we are.
Okay, then.
It is Serial Killer September.
Ooh. That throws open many, many options.
Would you like to narrow that down a bit more, Ken?
Of which we will not be taking you up on. so you know all the famous serial killers that you've got out there. You've got your Ted Bundys. You've got Al Bundy, his brother. You've got Son of Sam. You've got Dahmer. You've got Ed Gein. You've got Edmund Kemper. You've got Eileen Wuornos. You know your basics there that you've got, and they've all got films about them. Well, we're going to be covering none of those fucking films whatsoever. So
no.
Don't even think that it's actually that related as much like this one.
Yeah.
Yeah, we're going to pick out some absolutely mental fucking choices. They've got nothing to do with this theme, quite as you know it.
Yeah. We're picking out an underground gore-fest classic that you've probably maybe never heard of, but if you have, you'll be fucking delighted that we're covering it, because I know we are. We're covering a fucking ridiculous film from the 50s, because there's got to be slashers from the 50s, right? Or serial killers. There is, and we're covering one of them. And also another one.
Another one. And you know what that one is? That was someone else's choice.
Yeah.
And you know what we might even do? We might bring them on to fucking talk us through it themselves.
That's right. We might have a special guest for the very first time on this podcast, if they can be fucking arsed to get their finger out.
Yeah, and they've also said don't big them up too much because the disappointment will be overwhelming for people.
Yeah, but you know, that's just life.
Yeah, you're used to it if you're listening to us.
It's no one famous, by the way. It's one of our friends or relatives.
Of course it fucking isn't.
It's not going to be anyone you know, but it's going to be a third voice.
But it's going to be somebody that we know, and that's the main thing.
Well, hopefully they actually might be on that 50s one as well if they...
Oh, it depends how they prove themselves.
Yeah.
You know, bringing them on for one, maybe stick around for two.
Perfect. But until then, we will see you in September. We hope you've tried your best to be... I know it's been difficult, but we hope you've tried your best to enjoy this month.
Yeah, I didn't think Dom would still be here, to be honest, after that first one.
But he is.
Yeah, if you've got any guesses of what we're going to be covering, throw them in, because it'll be fucking wrong, all of them.
Yeah.
100%. No way are you guessing any of our Serial Killer September films. And if you do, I'll give you a shiny coin.
That's something to look forward to.
There we go.
See you next time, everybody.
Goodbye now.
What does it take to change the essence of a man? I need time to change.